Welcome to you all.
We're here for a very special event that I'll introduce in a moment. An event of great importance a couple of days before the primary here in New York. And this event will be recorded and available to viewers, listeners of WBAI and the Real News Network. I want to thank them both for being here. I'm Mark Crispin Miller. I'm a professor at New York University, and I'm very pleased to have been asked to moderate this event, and I think it's appropriate that I introduce it by recounting my own personal history with Scott Ritter, because that history is really quite relevant to what our guests are going to talk about tonight. I don't know if Scott will ever forgive me for this, but I'm actually responsible for introducing him to the public. In 1992, I was researching the first Gulf War, which most of the people in this room are old enough to remember. It didn't last very long, so it may be easy to forget by contrast with the war that's essentially still going on. I thought that the first Gulf War was a real propaganda masterpiece because there was a long, long buildup in the second half of 1990 leading up to the U.S.-imposed deadline of January 15th, 1991. And throughout those months, the government, the military, repeatedly implied that that war was going to be a disaster comparable to Vietnam. I don't know if you remember this, but we kept hearing that Saddam Hussein has the world's fifth largest army, and there was all kinds of propaganda out there hyping the dangerousness of the Iraqi military. So everybody was kind of terrorized until the war started a day or two beyond the deadline, just to intensify the suspense a little more. Started at prime time, Eastern Standard Time, 7 p.m., and within hours, it appeared that the war had been won. How many of you remember this, right? Watching it on CNN, as we all did, we heard nothing but good news, that Saddam Hussein's air force had been destroyed on the ground, that his dreaded Scud launchers had mostly been destroyed, there were no American casualties. We heard this over and over again. Now, for the first 2 hours, of the war, before we started to hear all that good news, there was all kinds of, there were many, many stories by CNN reporters, military bases, talking to terrified military wives, crying and hoping that their men would come home safe and sound. At 9 p.m., George Bush Sr. came on, a picture of calm and command, and spoke confidently about the righteousness of our cause and so on. And it was right after that that all the good news started to come in. So it really looked like he was somehow comparable to God himself, that he had willed this miraculous victory. All right, now, this struck me as dubious, to say the least, so I started to research it. And providentially, my research assistant, Jeffrey Blitz, got in touch with Scott Ritter, and Scott told us that contrary to the contrary to the hype we were hearing night after night from General Norman Schwarzkopf, who would always list all the victories of that day and kept repeating that we destroyed 11 mobile Scud launchers today, and then 13 more the next day, and then another 8 the next day. And it, if you added all the numbers up, it actually exceeded the number of Scud launchers that Iraq even possessed, right? Scott was able to tell us, based on firsthand experience, that they hadn't destroyed a single one, not one. So I wrote a piece about this for the New York Times op-ed page called Operation Desert Sham, and Scott was on the record. As I say, he may not forgive me for this, but that was the first time the American public had heard of him. He also gave us a tip, which we verified independently about the death that first night of Colonel Scott Spiker, the pilot who actually perished during that first wave of attacks on Iraq. But that was suppressed for days because it would have messed up the narrative of perfect victory. So I and the American people both owe Scott Ritter a great deal just on that basis. But he went on, as I hope you all know, to make a genuinely heroic effort to avert the Second Gulf War, for which he paid dearly, because the whole establishment went after him. And at the risk of sounding self-promotional, but actually because I want people to know his story, I strongly recommend that you get hold of my book, Cruel and Unusual, which has a whole chapter meticulously tracking what happened to him after he made that effort to prevent that war. Now, it's appropriate that he's here to talk about the foreign policy views and attitudes towards war on the part of the two Democratic candidates who will, the main players in the primary this Tuesday. He has some personal experiences with Hillary Clinton that are very relevant and that people should know before they vote. I'm going to, even though I only just met Ray McGovern for the first time this evening, I want to take my hat off to him as well. He too has been a heroic fighter for peace. And also paid for this when he protested, peacefully protested, a speech by Hillary Clinton. Was this 2011?
Right.
He turned his back on her while she was speaking, and they dragged him out of the room and beat him up. He talked about it on Democracy Now. So, as I say, I'm honored to be here. That's my introduction. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Scott Ritter and Ray McGovern.
Well, thank you very much for very kind words of introduction. I have forgiven you.
Okay.
And it's an honor and a privilege to be here tonight to speak with you. I'm going to do my best to discuss a difficult topic in a nonpartisan fashion. We're in the midst of a very partisan primary season, and on the Democratic side, we have two candidates who are about as different as one can get, especially when we talk about foreign policy. We have a candidate who is a former Secretary of State, former First Lady, who has a resume that one would think is ideal for the task of being Commander-in-Chief. And then we have another candidate, independent representative slash senator from Vermont with little or no foreign policy experience. And it seems it would be a slam dunk in favor of experience. We live in a difficult time. I'm not going to take us around the world. I'm going to focus on the Middle East and what I refer to as America's addiction to interventionism, regime change. Talk about four case studies: Iraq, Libya, Syria, and Iran. I'm going to start with Iraq because it sort of sets the foundation for the entire discussion of American intervention, at least the modern iteration of American intervention. And when I speak of Iraq, I'm not going to talk just in terms of what seems to be the greatest point of conflict between candidate Sanders and candidate Clinton. That is, their respective votes for war on Iraq in 2002. Bernie Sanders has famously said, "I voted against the war," and Hillary has infamously said, "I'm sorry for voting for the war." And one would say that that seems to color the two candidates, but it doesn't. It's the situation in the story is much more complex than that, and I think that we owe it to ourselves to understand that. To understand what happened in 2002, we need to go back to 1990, when Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait. Prior to the invasion in 1990, Saddam Hussein's Iraq had, in 1979, been placed on the state sponsor of terrorism list. Saddam Hussein was characterized as a rogue leader of a rogue nation who was pursuing weapons of mass destruction. So right there, you've got the three basic building blocks for American intervention. We tend to demonize a nation, delegitimize a nation by calling it a rogue state. Usually a rogue state led by a crazy dictator. And then we go further and say that this rogue state represents a threat to international peace and security, and indeed the entire world order, by speaking of the rogue state's links to terrorism, usually as a state sponsor of terrorism. And then we go further to create this nexus between terrorism and weapons of mass destruction. So now we have the ingredients of a global catastrophe. A rogue state that sponsors terrorism and possesses weapons of mass destruction. Now, this is a situation that was starting to bubble up in 1979, 1980, 1981. But suddenly the scenario became inconvenient, you see, because Iraq invaded Iran, and Iran started winning the war. And now we had a situation where another rogue state, this time the Iranians, were prevailing on the battlefield and threatening global supplies of oil. And so, with a magic wave of the wand, Iraq was no longer a state sponsor of terror. Saddam Hussein was no longer a rogue dictator heading up a rogue nation pursuing illegitimate weapons of mass destruction. Saddam Hussein overnight became a close friend and ally of the United States of America. We started providing him with intelligence. We started providing him with hundreds of million dollars of agricultural loans that allowed him to reallocate funds to acquire the ability to build his conventional weapons capability and his unconventional, i.e. weapons of mass destruction capability. And this was all fine and dandy with the United States so long as Saddam was focused on holding off the Iranian Shia horde that was threatening to take over much of the Arab oil-producing world. And then Saddam invaded Kuwait in August of 1990. Now, to show you how crass and how arbitrary and capricious our foreign policy is, overnight, this good friend of America, who was receiving hundreds of millions of dollars of our money, who got away with using chemical weapons against the Iranians and the Kurds during this period of time, suddenly was retransformed into the ultimate bad guy. He suddenly became a state sponsor of terror overnight. Why? Because he supported the Mujahideen al-Khalq, an Iranian opposition group that operated on Iraqi soil fighting the Iranians. He'd been supporting them for a decade. But now this support, which we had turned a blind eye to, suddenly allowed us to say, no, you're a state sponsor of terror. He supported the Palestinian Liberation Organization. He supported the Abu Nidal Organization. What's interesting about the Abu Nidal support is that actually his support comes at the end of a long and lengthy negotiation which had Abu Nidal sent to Baghdad under house arrest. So Saddam actually was facilitating the bringing about stability in the Middle East by bringing Abu Nidal out of the operational circle where he could commit acts of terror and place him under virtual house arrest in Baghdad. Yet the fact that Saddam did that, the United States used an excuse to label him a state sponsor of terror. And then, of course, we have his weapons of mass destruction programs. Now, we fought a war against Saddam, but before we fought this war, this is the Gulf War, we had to take it a step further. You see, Saddam went from being somebody who could receive a notary such as Donald Rumsfeld, embrace him, and call him a true friend, and be called a true friend of America, to being somebody who was labeled as the equivalent of Adolf Hitler. If you remember, in October of 1990, then-President George Herbert Walker Bush gave a speech in Cincinnati where he said that Saddam Hussein must be held accountable for his sin of invading Kuwait, and there must be Nuremberg-like retribution, referring to the Nuremberg trials, of course, which was the criminal prosecution of the Nazis of Germany in the aftermath of the Second World War. So in one fell swoop, Saddam Hussein didn't just become a rogue leader, he became the rogue leader, the modern-day equivalent of Adolf Hitler, who deserved Nuremberg-like retribution. Now, we fought this war. We weren't successful in getting rid of Saddam during this war. We were able to defeat the Iraqi army, but we were left with a situation where we had this dictator, whom we had demonized, who possessed weapons of mass destruction and was a state sponsor of terror, but he survived a war he wasn't supposed to survive. And what do we do about this? Well, there wasn't support for continuing military operations. A decision was made that we would contain Saddam through the vehicle of economic sanctions. And now we come to another one of these tools that you'll see pop up when we speak about American interventionism and regime change. Economic sanctions. Now, people call sanctions a policy. It's a tool of policy. I actually call it the tool of no policy. When you don't have a policy, when you don't have a viable policy, when you don't know what to do,
sanctions.
You impose sanctions because it buys you time, ostensibly contains the problem until which time you can come up with a solution. But here the solution was Saddam Hussein would collapse from within. You see, we would impose economic sanctions, keep them in place until either he lost the confidence of his commanding generals, his economy collapsed, or something else happened to remove him. The CIA gave him 6 months to live after the war. But we needed a justification for these economic sanctions. They had been originally imposed because Saddam invaded Kuwait. They're supposed to be lifted when Kuwait is liberated, which it was in February of 1991. So there was no longer legitimacy for the continuation of these sanctions. But we had to create a new legitimacy. It was called weapons of mass destruction. And that's where the United Nations resolutions to disarm Iraq came into play. The resolutions were passed. Economic sanctions were linked to Iraq's willingness to comply with its obligation to disarm. So long as Iraq was found to be non-compliant, sanctions would be in place. Now, originally, it wasn't supposed to be that complicated because the disarmament process was always going to take longer than 6 months. It was never about disarmament, ladies and gentlemen. It was always about containment. It was always about regime change. But Saddam fooled everybody by surviving longer than 6 months. And suddenly we were compelled to deal with the issue of how do we handle this man who we've called the modern-day equivalent of Adolf Hitler, who we say is a state sponsor of terror, and has weapons of mass destruction. What do? We didn't have an effective policy to deal with this. So we come to the next building block, the imposition of no-fly zones. You see, we sanction, and then the next non-policy is to create no-fly zones that limit the ability of a sovereign nation to operate within its own borders, to impose its will on its own people. We imposed one in the north to limit Saddam's ability to deal with the Kurdish population in the north, and we did one in the south to limit his ability to deal with the Shia population in the south. Again, we didn't do this because we really cared about the Kurds or the Shia. We did this because we cared about destabilizing Saddam Hussein by helping facilitate his demise and his downfall. Saddam surprised everybody by continuing to survive. Year after year, he survived. In 1996, then-President Clinton, who inherited this policy from President Bush. And when he inherited, you know, it's not as though he inherited sort of half-heartedly. When he was President-elect Bill Clinton in January prior to his inauguration, he said, I support this policy wholeheartedly, that the policy of the Bush administration on Iraq is my policy and will be my policy, and it was his policy. But it was a policy that was a non-policy. They didn't really know how to deal with Saddam. We sanctioned him, we have no-fly zones, but Saddam continues to survive. Now, what happens when politicians over and over and over again eat the red meat of interventionism? What is the red meat of interventionism? It's saying you have a rogue leader. a rogue nation. It's saying that they are state sponsors of terror. It's saying that they possess weapons of mass destruction. Then it creates a nexus that brings all of this together to create a threat, a fundamental threat to the security of the United States and the rest of the world. If you say this long enough, people start believing it. And when people start believing it, they start believing that something has to be done. And in 1998, this lack of policy solidified into a genuine policy that was put forward under the moniker of the Iraq Liberation Act. It started off as basically a policy statement by the leading conservative foreign policy minds, but it became the law of the United States. Why? Because the United States House of Representatives voted on it, and the United States Senate voted on it. Guess who voted for the Iraq Liberation Act in October of 1998? Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders bought into the red meat. Bernie Sanders publicly said that Saddam Hussein is a brutal dictator who should be removed. Now, when you say you have a brutal dictator who should be removed, what does that mean? It means just that, regime change. Everybody in the United States bought into this. Not every, I mean, you can point to an individual here and there, but the key players across the board said Saddam Hussein had to go. The problem wasn't so much the substance of the message. There was universal agreement that Saddam had to go. The problem was the process in getting rid of him. We still didn't quite know how that was going to happen. In December of 1998, when then President Bill Clinton started Operation Desert Fox, targeting Iraq's weapons of mass destruction program, and running a covert coup attempt against Saddam at the same time, Representative Bernie Sanders stood up in the House and was opposed to it. Now, his speech in opposition, on one hand, doesn't make too much sense. When just 2 months prior, he said, no, regime change is the policy of the United States. But now he's saying that we're bombing them, trying to get rid of them. This isn't right. See, Bernie was about process. He wasn't upset that we were bombing Iraq. He wasn't upset that we were targeting Saddam. He wasn't even upset that we were bombing sites ostensibly related to weapons of mass destruction, even though they weren't. He was upset that the president didn't go to Congress and get permission to do this. Now, this can be a criticism, but it actually says a lot about the man, because you can't condemn somebody for buying into the red meat. I'm here to tell you right now, you're not going to be a successful American politician if you swim against the current all the time. When you have the vast majority of the people embracing this formula of regime change, of interventionism, that's built upon the notion of rogue state, state sponsor of terror, weapons of mass destruction, it's hard to stand up and say, no, Saddam's not a rogue leader. I had a general once tell me, when I was explaining to him why I was right, he said, Ritter, when you're explaining, you're losing. And that's pretty much true. If you're a politician, it has to be explaining to his constituency why Saddam Hussein's not as evil as everybody says he is, you're losing. If you're explaining why he's not a state sponsor of terror, you're losing. If you're explaining why his weapons of mass destruction programs aren't as dangerous as everybody else says they are, you're losing. But if you have the courage to stand up and say that the president is operating in a manner that violates the Constitution of the United States of America, you got a winning hand at that point in time. And Bernie was playing a winning hand in December of 1998. And the reason why I bring this up is that that moment, December 1998, Operation Desert Fox, is directly segues into this important vote October of 2002, the vote for the war in Iraq. Hillary Clinton, in justifying her vote for the war in 2002, pointed to what happened in December of 1998. She said, I supported Operation Desert Fox then, and I support it now. She said, my husband did a wonderful job bombing Iraq back then. He was justified then, and we will be justified doing it again today. He had weapons of mass destruction back then, and it was worthwhile bombing him. He has weapons of mass destruction today. Therefore, it's worthwhile eliminating this problem. The Iraq Liberation Act said we must remove Saddam, and now you have a president, George W. Bush, who was going to get rid of Saddam. Policies finally marrying up with the statements we had put out. The problem, though, is that none of the stuff that we said about Iraq, none of the stuff that was used to justify the war, was true. Saddam wasn't a threat worthy of war. He wasn't a state sponsor of terror. There was no nexus between Saddam Hussein's Iraq and al-Qaeda, an organization that was responsible for 9/11. And yet, who do we invade? Iraq. Now, what's the importance of this is it's not just a history lesson, because we have to understand that Iraq didn't happen in a vacuum. I mentioned three other locations where there's conflict. Libya in 2011. What happened with Libya? Muammar Gaddafi. What did we do to Muammar Gaddafi? We labeled him a rogue nation, a rogue leader. We labeled him a state sponsor of terror. We said he was pursuing weapons of mass destruction. Bill Clinton in 1996 spoke about the nexus between rogue states, weapons of mass destruction, state sponsor of terrorism in picking on Libya. In 1996, we passed the Iran-Libya Sanctions Act. Remember that word, sanctions, one of those tools. So we started sanctioning Libya. Libya got a little off kilter, though, because in 2002, Muammar Gaddafi took a look at what was happening in Iraq and said, I don't want that to happen to me. And so he said, guess what I'm going to do, guys? I'm going to voluntarily disarm. You can come in. You can get rid of my chemical weapons. You can get rid of all the stuff I have. I have a nuclear weapons program. You know what the irony of that nuclear weapons program was? There was no nuclear weapons program in Libya until we sanctioned them, until we isolated them, until we called them a rogue state, until we called them a state sponsor of terror. At that point in time, Libya said, okay, if that's how you're going to treat us, we're going to pursue a nuclear weapons program. And they did. They got caught, and Muammar Gaddafi decided to give it up. In 2011, when we finally started moving in on Libya militarily, we hadn't completed the disarmament of his chemical weapons. We hadn't completed the disarmament of his nuclear weapons program. This was still in play, and yet we got rid of him anyways. Here's a man who's cooperating with the international community to get rid of the weapons that we claim represent such a great threat. Here's a man whom the United States relied on. You know, one of the great ironies of the whole Libya debacle is that when the CIA started sending in their special activities guys to work with the opposition group on the ground, guess who they met coming out? The CIA guys who were on the ground training Muammar Gaddafi's security forces. So you had one group of CIA guys who were helping Gaddafi leaving as the other group of CIA guys who were going to get rid of Gaddafi came in. That tells you that this policy had no no grounding in reality. But it was a policy that pretty much had to happen because we had the building blocks in place. Once you label a state a rogue nation, once you call it a state sponsor of terror, once you say it has weapons of mass destruction, once you sanction it, and then once you put no-fly zones in, the rest of the story is already been written. Gaddafi had to go. And this was what Hillary Clinton pushed as Secretary of State. She pushed a policy of regime change that mirrored, in every sense of the word, the regime change building blocks that we had used against Iraq. We used the same building blocks, maybe a little variation here and there, to go against Libya. Now, here's the problem. What did Bernie Sanders do when a sense of the Congress vote was taken about Libya? He voted in favor of the imposition of a no-fly zone. Why? Because Bernie, like any American politician, is about the red meat. If you're explaining, you're losing. Gaddafi has been painted as a brutal dictator. Bernie Sanders' first words, Muammar Gaddafi is a brutal dictator who has to go. He has weapons of mass destruction. They have to be removed. He is a threat, an ugly threat. But again, Sanders' position was we needed to go to the United Nations. We need to get international support. We need to do it the right way. He never had a chance to vote against the Libya action because when the Senate finally had an opportunity to bring it up to vote, the vote got canceled through some parliamentarian actions, delays by the Republicans trying to link the vote to some budgetary issues. So we'll really never really know truly how Bernie Sanders felt in the summer of 2011. He says that he was aligned against the military intervention. The problem is his voting record in the spring of 2011 doesn't back that. He supported the imposition of a no-fly zone that led to the disaster we have today. Now, Barack Obama has called Libya his greatest mistake. And the architect of Libya was Hillary Clinton. So I don't think we need to spend too much time talking about who is to blame for Libya. But Hillary Clinton is a mainstream politician. Hillary Clinton is a mainstream national security advocate. Bernie's putting himself as somebody who's not mainstream, who walks to a different drum. But the problem is, when we take a look at his record on Iran or on Iraq and Libya, he's pretty much in step. He's pretty much in step, and this is bothersome. So now we come to part three, Syria. Hillary's record on Syria is quite clear. She's labeled the president of Syria, Bashar al-Assad, a rogue leader. Syria is a state sponsor of terror. Syria possesses weapons of mass destruction. Hillary's in favor of sanctioning Syria. We are sanctioning Syria. And Hillary wants to impose a no-fly zone. What did that tell you is going to happen in Syria if Hillary has her way? There'll be yet another American-led intervention leading to regime change. The problem is, though, that Syria is falling apart. The American policy of Syria is falling apart under the weight of its own lies. If you go to 2011, in the start of the Syrian civil war, the narrative that's being played out is that Bashar al-Assad brutally suppressed a peaceful rising of the Syrian public. I would ask the people in this audience to take a look at a town in Syria, Jisr al-Sagur, and take a look at what happened in that town from April of 2011 till June of 2011, and tell me if you think that was a peaceful uprising. It was actually a well-funded, well-trained, well-organized jihadist uprising, deliberately targeting the Syrian government. A lot of the lies that we've embraced, that Hillary Clinton and others have embraced about Syria, emerged from the Jisr al-Sagur event. To give you one big one, the Syrian army was defecting in droves to defend the Syrian people from the brutality of Bashar al-Assad. They even went so far as to put a lieutenant colonel, I believe his name was Hamoush, before the international public, and he said, I defected with my men, and we stood in the street, and we held off the Syrian regular army, Bashar's thugs, until the people could flee. And then we fled to Turkey, and we suffered horrendous casualties. The 60 and 70 dead soldiers you saw in the town of Jisr al-Sagur were my soldiers, slaughtered by Bashar al-Assad's people. None of this was true. The BBC finally hunted this guy down, and it turns out he wasn't even in the town at the time. He had defected afterwards. He went to Turkey, and he was brought in, and this was all a fabrication. The 60 or 70 people that were slaughtered were Syrian soldiers from a special intelligence unit, unarmed, who were captured by the Muslim Brotherhood and the jihadists, and then butchered, along with policemen. That was the nature of the peaceful uprising. Now we take a look at, weapons of mass destruction. We're told that Syria used chemical weapons against its own people. That story's already been discounted. The United Nations went in, did inspections, and has shown that the nerve agent that was used in these attacks is not the nerve agent that's associated with the Syrian government. How do we know this? Well, we actually destroyed the Syrian nerve agent. We put it on an American ship, the Cape May, that has a detailed laboratory that basically tested it, and we have the DNA, the chemical equivalent of the DNA of this nerve agent. We know for a fact that the stuff that was used against the Syrian civilians in August of 2013 was not Syrian government nerve agent. More than likely, it was nerve agent that was brought in through Turkey, facilitated by Turkish intelligence, handed over to offshoots of the al-Nusra Front, who then used these to attack civilian populations to create a false flag incident to try and get the United States dragged into this war. But it fell apart. It fell apart because the lies were not sustainable. It also fell apart because Russia intervened. And Russia basically said, rather than go to war, why don't we just get rid of the chemical weapons? John Kerry said, well, we could do that, but Syria will never go along with that. Syria went along with it. Next thing we know, all the chemical weapons are gone, and the narrative fell apart. But what's dangerous about this narrative is that Bernie Sanders continues to eat the red meat. He continues to put forward a narrative that says, for instance, Assad is a horrendous dictator who's been at war with his own people. How do you come up with this statement? First of all, it's because the press has basically said that hundreds of thousands of Syrians have been killed in this civil war. And then they automatically say that the person solely responsible for these deaths is Bashar al-Assad. But if you break down the casualties, you'll find out that closer to 450,000 people have been killed. The vast majority of them, anywhere from 98,000 to 147,000, are Syrian government forces. Another 104,000, 150,000 are rebel forces. So fully four-fifths of the casualties are military casualties. This is not a government slaughtering its own people. This is a nation engaged in a brutal civil war. There are civilians dying. Somewhere around 85,000 civilians have died. Upwards of 20,000 have died at the hands of Syrian government aerial bombardment. This is a horrible statistic. It's tragic. But you know, when we invaded Normandy on June 6, 1944, we lost 4,400 people, Americans, British, Canadians, French soldiers on the beaches that day. Over 1,000 Germans were killed. But what's not talked about are the 6,000 Frenchmen and women and children who died that same day as a direct result of the fighting. Civilians die during wartime. It is a tragic reality. It doesn't mean that Bashar al-Assad is butchering them. It means that a horrible war is taking place and civilians are caught in the crossfire. Or if you want a more modern example, let's talk about the Battle of Fallujah. American forces fighting in Iraq. 107 Americans and allies were killed in the fighting that took place over the course of several months. Around 1,500 insurgents were killed. Nearly 1,000 civilians died in that fighting as well. Now that's a casualty rate that's even greater percentage-wise than what we see taking place in Syria today. That's just one battle, one urban battle. Urban battles being fought over and over and over again in Syria. And yet we condemn Bashar al-Assad for waging the exact same kind of war that we waged in Iraq. But for us, the civilian casualties are legitimate collateral consequence of legitimate war. Bernie has said that Assad is killing his own people. It's not true. Bernie's eating the red meat. He says his use of chemical weapons is abhorrent and violative of international law. But we now know that Assad didn't use chemical weapons. Bernie says that Assad must depart in order for there to be a solution to the Syrian conflict. But why does Assad need to go? He only needs to go because America's come up with this building block formulation of interventionism and regime change that Bernie Sanders has embraced. Fortunately for Bernie Sanders, the lies about Syria are collapsing, and he may be in a position, if elected, to reverse course. If Hillary's elected, we know what she's going to do: impose a no-fly zone that will lead to direct military intervention that the desires of regime change. It'll be the exact same formula we used in Iraq and in Libya, played out again in Syria. The last one, though, the one that gives me hope, is Iran. As with Libya, since 1990, we've been demonizing the Iranians. We've been sanctioning them. We've been accusing them of having weapons of mass destruction. We've been accusing them of being state sponsors of terror. There was a real danger a couple years ago that during the Bush administration that we might actually have military intervention in Iran over its nuclear program. The United States went overboard in pitching the Iranian nuclear program as a military threat, as an actual nuclear weapons program. But it couldn't sustain itself. The lies could not be sustained, and it collapsed in its own weight. And what we have today is a nuclear agreement between Iran and the rest of the world that has resolved its nuclear issue. And if you think about it for a second, it's quite remarkable. We had pitched a nuclear agreement as being a genuine, the Iranian nuclear threat as being a nuclear weapons threat. We said they had a nuclear weapons capability. We pointed to American intelligence estimates that said they have an active nuclear weapons capability. We sold a bill of goods to the International Atomic Energy Agency, the United Nations inspectors, saying these guys have possible military dimension stuff. They have stuff going on that's very suspicious, and it's stuff that we have to be willing to go to war to stop if they won't disarm. But Iran didn't play that game. Iran kept saying, we're going to have our peaceful nuclear program. And at the end of the day, the United States was forced to recant. Overnight, the PMI issue, or PMD issue, the possible military dimension issue, went from being a reason to go to war to being a non-issue, because the United States was willing to just write it off. Hillary Clinton brags about how she pushed for economic sanctions and how sanctions drove Iran to the table. The opposite's the truth. Sanctions drove the United States to the table. You see, the longer we had sanctions, the bigger the Iranian program was. When we first started sanctioning them about their nuclear program, there weren't any centrifuges. Then in 2002, 2003, there was 186 or so centrifuges. We kept telling the Iranians, you have to stop. They kept saying no. By the time, this time, a year and a half ago, there was nearly 20,000 centrifuges spinning, and Iran was getting ready to build even more. It wasn't Iran that was forced to the negotiating table. It was the United States that was forced to the negotiating table. The United States changed its position. Its position under Hillary Clinton was not one single centrifuge will be allowed in Iran. She left the Secretary of State, John Kerry came in, and instantly we got a new position, which is Iran will be allowed to have a peaceful nuclear program inclusive of a uranium enrichment capability. American policy collapsed under the weight of its own lies. And this is a good thing, because guess who voted in support of the Iranian nuclear accord? Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders voted in support of it. And this shows that this is a man, while he's as human as the rest of us and as American as the rest of us and capable of eating the red meat, is also capable of seeing through the lies and doing the right thing. So when you take a look at the two candidates today, I think we have a stark choice. We have a choice of more of the same, a continuation of Iraq, Libya, and Syria, or we have the ability to change course and bring somebody in who, although in the past was a facilitator of American policies of intervention, has shown that when it comes time for actual implementation, he's able to tack us away from a policy of confrontation. And I think these are the two stark choices we have when taking a look at these candidates today. Sorry for speaking so long, and I'll turn it over to Ray.
Well,
thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Well, I too want to welcome you all for coming. There's no mic here, so if you can't hear me in the back, please raise your hand and I'll speak louder. It's my privilege to be up here with these two straight shooters. I was delighted that Mark Crispin Miller helped us so much in getting this hall in liaising with the church here, a very hospitable church, and I want to thank them on the record. I also want to read, as at my earliest opportunity, Cruel and Unusual, the book that Mark has written. I haven't read that yet, but I keep learning new and new things about Mark and about Scott, and I learned a couple tonight. Let me just say, in a kind of a broad sense, a kind of a keynote sense, that Mark is particularly interesting and important because of what he does with respect to the media. Now, I just celebrated last week my 53rd anniversary of my arrival in Washington. Okay, John Kennedy was president. I had a new job with the CIA, detailed from the military. So I say that because 53 years is a long time, and you see a lot of change in 53 years, don't you? Well, there's one change that dwarfs all the other changes put together in this 53-year period, and that is that we no longer have, in any real sense, a free media, and that is big. That couldn't be bigger. All of my colleagues, the people I went to Fordham with for 4 years, for 8 years, sometimes for 9 years, they don't know about me because I say things that aren't in the New York Times. Can you believe it? Well, they can't believe it if it's not in the New York Times. Now, that's big. It didn't used to be that way. When I referred to the New York Times, historically, I have to say, well, it used to be an independent newspaper, and it did. You could leak stuff or you tell stuff to the New York Times, they put it on the front page after they proofed it. Now, well, if it might hurt George W. Bush's reelection chances, well, they'll sit on it for over a year, as they did with the news they had of the interception program of all our emails and telephone calls. You know, that journalist had that information 2 months before the election in 2004. The Times sat on it. And they only published it, James Risen's stuff. They published it when Risen went to them and said, "Now, you know, it's a little awkward. My book is in galley. You're paying me big bucks, and it's going to be a little embarrassing when the book comes out and you haven't reported that Bush, Cheney, and the NSA are intercepting all our telephone conversations and our emails." So I just want to go on record as saying that, because that changes everything in terms of what I was used to in the old days, let's say. The Scud story. Here's a new thing I learned tonight. Scott and I were having a pizza not too far away from here. And I was, Mark had told us that he was going to tell the story about the Scuds, none of which were destroyed. Well, General Schwarzkopf was very, very angry that none were destroyed. So he was wanting to make sure that some were destroyed. And sure enough, he announced to the press, we got several of them. We just destroyed them. And the way it came to me out of Colin Powell's book was some junior imagery analyst said, "No, those were oil tankers." And Schwarzkopf's intelligence guy, Admiral, what's his name, the guy who became
McConnell.
McConnell went to Schwarzkopf and said, "Well, you know, this troublesome analyst says they're oil tankers." And so that got to the White House, and Powell called up Schwarzkopf and said, "General Schwarzkopf, we hear from the bowels of your unit there that they weren't Scuds, that they were oil tankers." Now, Powell says that Schwarzkopf used every vulgar, every piece of cursing that Powell ever said, and Schwarzkopf says, no, he doesn't know what he's talking about. They were Scuds. And so Powell, you know, no profile in courage, Powell said, "Oh, all right, you say they were Scuds? They were Scuds." Next day, front page of the New York Times, pictures of these oil tankers, these Jordanian oil tankers, destroyed at the place where the Scuds were supposed to be. So I said to Scott, chewing on a pizza, I said, "You know, I don't know who that guy was, but he spoke the truth. I wonder what happened to him." And guess what Scott said to me? Guess, anybody?
"He was fired."
"Yeah, what?"
"You're eating pizza with him."
"Yeah, that's what he said. You're eating pizza with me, with him." I said, well, what happened, Scott?" He said, "Well, you got fired, right?"
"Yeah,
on the spot, you know. You tell the truth, you get fired." And we all are familiar with that. Now, this leads me to the next little test of Scott's character and my naivete. We're talking about Hillary Clinton. It wasn't a mistake, folks. It wasn't a mistake that had her vote for the Iraq War. It was a calculated, cynical, political move, because she knew that she had to be tough if she was to get her turn to be president of the United States. She didn't want to know any of this stuff. She didn't want to know any of the truth. And, you know, we have that example A. 4 weeks before the attack on Iraq in March of 2003, somebody leaked the debriefing report that was taken from Hussein Kamel, one of Saddam Hussein's sons-in-law. Okay, he defected to Jordan, and in 1955, he spilled the beans. CIA, British, UN interrogators, they said, "Well, thanks for coming out. Now, where are the weapons of mass destruction?" And Hussein Kamel said, "Well, they were all destroyed." Interrogators, right. "How do you know they were destroyed?" "Well, you didn't do your research? You don't know that I was in charge of that program?" "Yeah, but how do you know they were destroyed?" Well, I don't know how it works in the West, but I was in charge of that program, right? And I ordered them destroyed. So they were destroyed, okay? Yeah, how do you know? Well, I've checked some samples. What do you want me to say, that they weren't? Is that what you want? You want me to say they're still there, you know? Well, they're not. They're destroyed. It's all in this beautiful debriefing report. Somebody leaked that to Newsweek 4 weeks, actually 5 weeks, before the attack on Iraq. What did the media do? Well, Newsweek put it in a little periscope. Remember the little periscope part of the, you know, just a small little item there? It certainly deserved more, but to their credit, they published a story. This was at the end of February 2003, and the stenographers, who used to be called journalists that we have in Washington, they said, oh my, this is not the narrative. We better check this out. So where would you go to check that out? Anyone? Oh, they went to the CIA, right? And the CIA guy said, well, no, it's bogus, untrue, it's false, and one other adjective they used here. False, untrue, wrong, bogus. So they pulled out the whole tray of adjectives that, you know, they use for really serious occasions. And what did the stenographers of the mainstream press do? Well, they said, oh, thanks so much, because we were thinking of writing a story on this. So thanks for telling us that it was bogus, untrue, and all this stuff. Now, that was out there, right? It was documentary. It was the debriefing report. I said to Scott several years ago, I said, I don't know who did that, who gave that to Newsweek, but that was the last great chance to stop this damn war. Guess what Scott told me? Anyone? It was me. So there's no end to the truth-telling character of this guy. He tried his best to stop this darn war. You haven't told the story about trying to see Hillary, but we'll get into that a little bit later, I hope. But look, Hillary could have found out. Bob Graham, now, whatever you say about Bob Graham, he was the chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee, right? And he voted against the war. He saw the information. He may have been one of the four people who went down and read the estimate dated October 1st, which said, Saddam Hussein has all manner of weapons of mass destruction. He's a threat to everyone. And besides, there's a sinister nexus, your word, between Saddam Hussein and Al-Qaeda. Okay, yeah, well, that wasn't true, but she didn't even read it, okay? Hillary Clinton didn't read it. Now, we talked about Syria here. I'm just going to sow seriatim here because we want to do a lot of questions and answers. Syria is really big. Barack Obama feels real proud of Syria. Why? Because he didn't let himself get mousetrapped. Scott just kind of mentioned that in passing, but this is a real, real interesting case study, if you will, if you want to do the Harvard Business School approach. Here's the case, all right? Saddam has to go. Who says? Hillary says. Who says? Barack Obama says. Okay. Why is he Netanyahu says. Yeah, well, that's what I'm getting to. So why does he have to go? Why does he have to go? Because who else says? Yeah, and Netanyahu. There was a very, very interesting slip that the New York Times made in October, first week of October, October 5th, actually, of 2013. What happened was this. There was a false flag attack, and the President of the United States was almost mousetrapped. Now, why was he almost mousetrapped? Well, because someone told one of the stenographers of the Washington Press to ask a question at a press conference of the president who said, we're not going to get military involved in Syria. And so the answer was, at the end, it was a very canned answer. It clearly came from Hillary Clinton. The question was, under what conditions would you change your military calculus here? Under what conditions would you attack Syria? And he, as though reading it from rote, said, "Well, if Bashar al-Assad moved or used chemical weapons, then I would change my calculus and then we might do a military thing." Well, now, a year later, all of a sudden, there's this attack outside Damascus, just incidentally, as UN inspectors come into Damascus to look at what's happened there. And what was it? It was blamed on Bashar al-Assad. Scott has already given the answer to this story. It wasn't Bashar al-Assad. It was the rebels. It was the rebels enforced or reinforced and facilitated by the Turkish intelligence service and other Western operatives working with the al-Nusra Front and others in southern Syria. So what happens? Well, a couple of people are killed with this sarin attack. But as Scott has already said, it's not the sarin that's in Syrian army stocks. It's a homemade sarin, okay? Who told us that first? The foreign minister of Russia, Lavrov. He said, it's homemade stuff. Who told us second? The British. They took it through their lab and said, no, this is homemade stuff. And then, of course, as Scott said, on the ship, they got the DNA of this stuff. So what was the idea? The idea was to mousetrap Barack Obama, who did it, Hillary Clinton, by placing that dare, you know, that red line into that press conference. And then a year later, they got their act together and they did a false flag attack. And Barack Obama was hours away from pushing the button, letting fly all manner of missiles to attack with shock and awe Syria. Why is he so proud of not doing that? Well, I think he's sensible enough to know that he was about to be had. Why does he get rid of Hillary Clinton? Why doesn't Barack Obama get rid of all these creeps that he's had advising him? You know, he tried to be Lincoln, and he fell flat in his face with this, you know, cooperation of people who are supposed to. Anyhow, this is a really interesting story because John Kerry, like Hillary Clinton, was in on it, that is, in on the subterfuge up to his neck. The sarin attack was on the 21st of August, 2013. John Kerry got up on the 30th of August at the State Department in a briefing, and he said no fewer than 35 times, Bashar al-Assad's responsible for this, Bashar al-Assad, Bashar al-Assad, Bashar al-Assad's government, all right? Okay. Now, you don't have to be a Shakespearean scholar to remember about protesting too much, right? What did he cite? He couldn't cite an intelligence assessment because there are enough honest analysts left in the intelligence community that wouldn't buy it, okay? So he created a new genre of report, a government assessment, which simply means it was made by political hacks in the White House and that the head of intelligence didn't have the guts to quit. So this is what Kerry cited. That was the 30th of August. On the 31st, the president got in the Rose Garden. And this was really interesting because I was out in front of the White House with about 100 other people, well, 200 other people, with all kinds of placards, no war, no strike on Syria, you know, this kind of thing. And we fully expected the president to get up and say, even as I speak, our warships in the Eastern Mediterranean and French fighter bombers on the tarmac, and blah, 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 blah. No, what'd he say? I couldn't believe it. He said, we've decided we're going to listen to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Dempsey. He's told me that we have our forces in position to attack Syria, but we don't have to do that today or tomorrow or even next week or next month. And so I'm going to go to Congress to seek appropriate authorization. Oh God! You know? Wow! I was the next speaker up at this little rally, and I had to use the subjunctive as never before. You know, if this is true, you know, if he really said that, but he did, okay? So he's very happy. He's very proud of that. And what does that mean? That means he realized that he was almost had by the likes of Hillary Clinton. Now, it's amazing that he's also admitted, as recently as last week, that, you know, if you got a mulligan, you know, if you got a do-over, it would be Syria, you know. So that wasn't a really smart thing. He said, you know, we just didn't plan for the next day. Well, hello? Where was he during Iraq, you know? Who didn't plan for the next day? Is that the president's job? Well, he should have somebody who could plan for the next day. And who was that? That was Hillary Clinton. No, she didn't plan for the next day. We came, we saw, he died. That's all she cared about, being tough, okay? So that's what you're going to get if you, her successor, John Kerry, is a real study. I don't know what happened to him. He has a long history, but something really strange happened to him because he became a neocon. He pushed for the attack on Iraq, on Syria, just as all the others did. And the president's very proud of that. He says, you know, Vice President Biden and everybody else was really disappointed with me for not attacking Syria. Now, the question was raised before, well, why Syria? You know, what kind of a threat is Syria to the United States? Well, the answer is none. Is Syria regarded as a threat to somebody else? Well, the answer is yes. Who's that somebody else? Israel. And during this period of time, when the president had said, no, we're not going to attack, there was a new New York Times Jerusalem bureau chief named Jody Ruderman. And she arrived a couple months before, and she was eager to find these things out. So she thought she'd speak to some Israeli officials about, you know, what their objectives are in Syria. And so she went around, she talked to some senior officials, including retired officials, and she said, well, what's your preferred outcome in Syria? And they said, well, Jody, this is going to sound like not very, it's a little awkward and it's not humanitarian, I suppose, but our preferred outcome is no outcome. And she said, I beg your pardon? Our preferred outcome is no outcome. And she said, would you explain that, you know? He said, well, as long as the Shia and Sunni are at each other's throats, not only in Syria, mind you, but in the whole area, Israel has nothing to fear from Syria. It's like a playoff game where you don't want either team to win and you don't want either team to lose. Well, hello, what was happening in the spring of 2013? Bashar al-Assad was starting to win. He had dislodged some of these ragtag rebels from places they had occupied for a couple of years. And so what needed to change the calculus? Get the U.S. in, mousetrap them into overt military involvement, and then it's not going to win, but at least Bashar al-Assad's not going to win. That's how cruel and calculating that calculus was. So, last thing here, I started to talk about Kerry. He went before Congress on the 3rd of September, 3 days after all this went down, and he told Congress, you know, we have to get your permission, we have to get your acknowledgement that we have to attack Bashar al-Assad, and besides, the moderates are winning, the moderates are winning, and everybody in Washington went, the moderates are winning. The president says there aren't. The president told Tom Friedman the notion that there are moderates in Syria, moderate rebels, is a fantasy. Fantasy, okay? And here John Kerry is saying the moderates are winning. Next day, Barack Obama arrives in St. Petersburg for one of these little summits. And that same day, Vladimir Putin, in an open meeting, said, you know, this fellow John Kerry, on vriot, on znayet, chto vriot, eto pechalnye, which means he lies, on znayet, chto, he knows he's lying. This is really sad. Barack Obama lands, and Putin says this. Well, Barack Obama knows the real story, too. So, he wasn't going to argue with him. Kerry was lying. Now, Kerry is on his way home 5 days later from London, and he has a press conference in London. This came up before. At the end of the press conference, where she's plugging for military attack on Syria, somebody says, but Secretary Kerry, is there nothing that Bashar al-Assad can do to avoid being attacked? And before the cameras, Kerry says, well, I mean, he could let all his chemical weapons be destroyed, but that's not in the card. That's not going to happen, you know. He gets on the plane, call from the president. John, I meant to mention this to you, but I've been talking with Putin, and we've arranged to have all the Syrian chemical weapons destroyed under our supervision, UN supervision. So when you come back, I want to see you right away, because I'm going to send you back to Geneva to conclude this deal. It was the most bizarre thing I've ever seen a Secretary of State say, having been cut out of the calculus there. Obama knew he had to go behind Kerry's back to get this done. He did it with Putin. They got the Syrian foreign minister to say, oh, yeah, that's fine, sure, destroy all our chemical weapons. And, you know, what Kerry had just said 2 days before, that's not going to happen. That's not in the cards. Of course, it happened. So this is the kind of thing that not only Hillary Clinton, but the people in the State Department, and specifically her successor, Kerry, that's the way they acted. Now, I want to say something. There's lots more to say here, but I want to talk about the email thing. Now, Bernie Sanders won great applause, including mine, when he said, I'm sick and tired of hearing about damn emails. Enough with the emails, all right? Well, that was a pretty grandiose, sort of grandfatherly, nice little gesture. But whether he knew it or not, he was dead wrong. That is very, very serious stuff. Now, Scott and I, maybe Mark, we know a little bit more about how this works. But putting that kind of stuff on a private email server is like giving it to the Russians. Who was it? One of my colleagues, Bill Binney, the head technology guy from the NSA, said it's just like having a mole at the top levels of your government. It's easy as pie to get this stuff. And this is very, very dangerous stuff. When you talk about, you know, they said, well, Bradley Manning, he endangered our troops in Afghanistan. Well, that was a lot of bull. Bobby Gates and all the others said, well, you know, yes, there's a great danger to our troops. And Carl Levin, the head of the Senate Armed Services Committee, to his credit, said, well, would you give me a memo on that, Secretary Gates? And Gates did, and 5 weeks later he came back, well, our fears were not substantiated. No one has been, he didn't say it this way, but no one had been so much as spat upon, you know, as a result of these emails. And Gates later asked publicly, he said, well, those stories about endangering troops from what Chelsea Manning revealed were significantly overwrought. Gates is away with words. Those were his words. They were significantly overwrought. Well, the comparison here is devastating because the damage done by virtue of Hillary Clinton putting this stuff on a private server is incalculable in many ways and endangers troops. Now look, Kerry was flying into Kabul last week. The Taliban took a couple pot shots at him, okay? Now this is very secret stuff. You know, the president comes in the middle of the night to Baghdad and says hello to the troops and then it gets right out. Well, you put that on a server, and the Taliban and other people will down that plane. Next Secretary of State will pay the price. And think about the blackmail potential. Think about it. You don't have to be kind of paranoid. Think about that. Now, people have the book on Hillary Clinton. They know who funded the Clinton Foundation. They know about conversations with Prince Bandar. They know all manner of things. So she is, in my view, eminently susceptible of blackmailing by people who know exactly how she arranged to get all these things done, and how, as Secretary of State, for the most part, she was able to parlay her position into personal profit. Now, truth in advertising or full disclosure, I try not to let the fact that I got beat up real bad sitting right in front of, or standing, I should say, right in front of Hillary Clinton. But just to give you an idea of how, well, sang-froid is not really the right term. I'd say it's a lack of basic human empathy with human suffering. Because what I did when she was speaking 5 years ago at George Washington University, I wangled a ticket. And I'll finish with this. I just want to say what happened. I had to hear her because it was a small little auditorium. It's the only chance McGovern gets to see a Secretary of State. I used to see him every other morning, right? Secretary Schultz and others. It was kind of fun. I still have my State Department badge. It doesn't work anymore, but at least I would have a chance to see Hillary Clinton speak. So we're waiting there for an hour, and she's supposed to be there at 12, 12:15. She comes 20 minutes late. As she comes in, everyone just jumps up, including me. And you know how the Russians, when they made a speech in Pravda the next day, after every other paragraph, the speech would say, "Burni aplodismenti, все стоят," which means stormy applause, everyone stands. Okay, and I'm saying, oh, I'm having a flashback. See? I'm saying, oh my God, so why are you standing, McGovern? So finally everybody sits down, and I stay standing. And I turn my back to her. And by stroke of luck, the only clean undershirt I had that day was my Veterans for Peace undershirt. So I took off my over thing, and I was just standing there quietly. And all of a sudden, I guess after about a minute and a half, when things seemed to be going well, this great big guy looked like a Redskins reject, you know, about 300 pounds, in a suit like this. He comes down. And he'd come down this aisle and say, oh, darn, you know, this is not going to last very long. And all of a sudden, before he even got 2 feet in front of me, I was taken down from the back by a guy I never saw. He happened to have a uniform on. He was one of the cops for GW University. I never saw him. I never even saw him after they got out and, you know, put two sets of steel cameras. Anyhow, she was standing there, and people say, well, what was she talking about? Well, she was talking about the need to respect dissent. In Iran, right? And did she miss? People say she didn't miss a word, you know. Well, she didn't miss a syllable. And Amy Goodman, to her, you know, to she's got a heart, you know. She had Mike Burke call me up and say, "Hey, would you come on a couple of days? Are you okay?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm all right." So I went on, and there's a 5-minute thing. Now let me just ask you before I bore you with this. How many people have seen this 5-minute thing where I explained to Amy Goodman what happened? Because I don't want to show it again if many have seen it. Okay, why don't we, can we show that, Ellen? And then we'll go to questions and answers if that's okay.
As we move into our last segment.
Someone get the light.
On Tuesday, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton gave a major address calling for internet freedom around the world. Speaking at George Washington University, Clinton condemned the Egyptian and Iranian governments for arresting and beating protesters.
What happened in Egypt and what happened in Iran, which this week is once again using violence against protesters seeking basic freedoms, was about a great deal more than the internet. In each case, people protested because of deep frustrations with the political and economic conditions of their lives. They stood and marched and chanted, and the authorities tracked and blocked and arrested them.
Just moments before Hillary Clinton spoke those words, a 71-year-old man was violently ejected from Clinton's own event and arrested for turning his back on the Secretary of State. TV cameras caught part of what happened.
Then the government pulled the plug. Cell phone service was cut off, TV satellite signals were jammed, and internet access was blocked for nearly the entire public.
So this is America.
The government.
This is America. Who are you?
Communicate with each other. And it did not want the press to communicate with the public.
The voice you heard screaming was that of Ray McGovern as he was dragged away by security guards who left him bruised and bloody. He was then arrested. McGovern is a former Army intelligence officer and a 27-year veteran of the CIA. He was one of the CIA's daily briefers for President George H.W. Bush. He has since become a vocal critic of U.S. foreign policy.
Ray McGovern joins us now in Washington, D.C. Ray, you were seriously hurt. Tell us what happened.
Well, I was pounced upon. I was blindsided, really. I was looking straight to the back, minding my own business, the only offense being standing up when everyone else was sitting down. And without any warning, I was pounced upon by, and what I'd call large manhandled, by a fellow that looked like an NFL football player in plain dress. I don't know who he was. That's why you hear me screaming, "Who are you? Who are you?" I never did get the answer to that. So it was really quite abrupt, quite violent, and the supreme irony, of course, is and sounds like something right out of Franz Kafka. Four paragraphs later, Hillary Clinton is saying what you just quoted her as saying. You know, one has to keep one's sense of humor in all this, especially when one bears these kinds of bruises, and I can't show you the ones down below. I was listening on the way in. I tuned in a little late to your show, and what I heard Hillary Clinton say, that little clip, "We strongly oppose the use of violence." This is yesterday. "We have deep concern over the actions of security forces." And I'm saying, yes! Oh, she's going to apologize like my Veterans for Peace colleagues has asked her to do. But then I realized she's talking about Bahrain, straight out of Kafka.
So you were seriously hurt. What parts of your body, what did they do to you?
Well, they put two sets of handcuffs on me, very roughly. They were the iron or the steel handcuffs. They dug into my wrist. Well, you could see some of the stuff right here. And they put it behind my back, of course, and I started bleeding profusely over my pants. We have the pants, they're full of blood. When somebody said, "Is that his blood?" One of the cops said, no, I pricked my finger." Right. The whole back seat of the pants is suffused with blood. They threw me, well, they didn't throw me. They placed me in a patrol car. I'm trying not to exaggerate here. I was taken up to one of the police headquarters in D.C., mugshotted, fingerprinted to a fare-thee-well, and put in a little cell of the size that Bradley Manning now occupies in Quantico.
Ray,
kept there for 3.5 hours.
Why were you there? Why did you, were you standing up?
I was standing up in silent witness to the fact that Hillary Clinton is responsible, partly responsible, for countless thousands of Iraqis, Americans, Afghans, and, God help us, Iranians, I hope not, and that she should not get the idea that everybody's going to sit down and applaud politely when there are so many of us that are usually excluded from these sessions who are feeling very, very, very sad and very angry at the foreign policy for our government. Very seldom do you have a chance to express that. I thought that I expressed that in the most nonviolent way by simply standing quietly with my back to her with a T-shirt that said Veterans for Peace.
Well, Ray McGovern, I want to thank you for being with us, the former top briefer of Vice President George H.W. Bush. Ray worked for the CIA for more than a quarter of a century. That does it for the show, democracynow.org. I'm Inigo Juan Gonzalez.
Why does everybody clap when I get beat up? There's just two little things I need to point out about this. The day after, there's an incredibly, well, they're in New York as well, the Partnership for Civil Justice Fund. They do incredible work. Those six people that were misdirected or trapped onto the Brooklyn Bridge, remember? And then they're all arrested during Occupy. That's the Partnership for Civil Justice Fund. They said, you know, "We can help you on this." And I said, "Well, I never sued anybody." Well, and I don't have any money. And they said, "Well, you don't understand. We do this for free." And I said, "Well, how do you exist?" And they said, "Well, we almost always win, and then the government pays a whole lot of money." Okay. Now, what they found out was that Hillary Clinton's folks did a bolo on me. Anybody know what a bolo is? Be on the lookout. Be on the lookout for this character. He doesn't have any suspicious record, but he has some notoriety in leftist circles. And if you see him, stop him, detain him, and call State Department security immediately. Whoa. Now, these lawyers got that lifted from the State Department, but a year later, when I tried to see General Petraeus at the 92nd Street Y, I was treated exactly the same way as I was treated. That night, I spent the whole night at the Tombs, okay? So the bolo was there for 6 months after they found out that I had no record, that I had, you know, there's no reason to keep me. Last thing, emails. Now, we had a FOIA out for emails, but of course, since nobody knew about Hillary Clinton's unique arrangement for emails, we didn't get anything from our discovery, that's what they call it, discovery stuff. And then when the last tranche was released, we looked at them. Oh, there's an email from Sidney Blumenthal, Hillary Clinton's private CIA director. He's the one that invents stories about Gaddafi giving Viagra to his troops so they can violate all the women in Africa. You know, sort of like that incubator story before Iraq. Sidney is a great guy. Okay, so he sends her a little email. He says, now, you should know about this, an unfortunate incident. This fellow McGovern, who has a certain reputation in lefty circles, he was a CIA analyst, but now he's a Christian anti-war leftist witness that goes around doing these things. But don't worry, he's harmless, right? He's harmless, okay? But you might want to apologize. Now, she didn't apologize, of course, but what I'm saying here, it's not about McGovern, it's about the emails, damn it. You know, if they're not going to release some stupid thing about what happened to McGovern, what else are they hiding, for God's sake? You know, it reminds me of what Joe Wilson, Ambassador Joe Wilson, said after they released the name of his deep cover wife. He revealed that there were no yellow cake shipments from Niger and deeper Africa. And then he said, and this is what got him in real trouble, this raises the question with respect to what else they're lying about. Well, they're lying about all of it, as you know. And this was, you know, with respect to Iraq. Now, how about these little emails? You know, the fact that they didn't release this little thing about Sidney telling his client there, Hillary, that you know, she might want to think about apologizing, but he's what is the word again? He's harmless. Yeah, it's harmless, so you don't really have to do anything. Well, if they didn't let that out into the open, what else are they hiding? And what I'm saying here is that we professional intelligence analysts and operators who've been at this for hundreds of years, the group we have, Veteran Intelligence Professionals for Sanity, we know. We know what kind of compromises. We know what kind of dangers. We know what kind of programs have been compromised that cost billions, not millions, but B with a boy, billions of dollars. I've seen it. I've seen it happen. And what you have to do is uncreate these things and start anew with a wholly different program that costs extra billions. Now, who profits from that? The military, industrial, congressional, security services, media complex. That's who. But that's for our later discussion. I just want to add those little things about the email and about the bolo. I think the bolo may have been still in effect when, as soon as I got into the 92nd Street Y a year and a half ago, I was met by the head of their security who said, Ray, you're not welcome here. I said, what? He said, you're not welcome here. I said, I have a ticket. I had gotten a ticket through a cutout, actually. That's what I had to do. I said, well, let's look at the back of your ticket. It says we can deny you entry anytime. I had printed out the ticket, right? So I looked at the back. I had nothing here, so I went to the turnstiles. NYPD was right there, grabbed me. I had fractured my shoulder earlier that week, so it was pretty painful. But long story short, I was cited for resisting arrest because of the thing, and put in the tombs. And I don't know how many of the others of you have been in the tombs, but Dostoevsky famously said that if you want to measure the level of a civilization, go visit its prisons. I recommend that every New Yorker, every American, if it were possible, spend one night, just one night, but one night in the tombs and see how you get treated as subhuman. See how you get treated as I wouldn't even say it. So it was an educational experience. All these things are educational experience. The last thing I'll say is this. I see that there are several people with my color hair out there, okay? Well, when I got beat up, my Veterans for Peace friends put the word out, a 71-year-old at the time man had been brutalized. Now, Hillary Clinton got tens of thousands of emails and telephone calls. Why? Because American people don't like old people to get beat up, all right? Young people, they got it coming to them. You know, so what I'm saying is, anybody with this color hair out there, you got a big advantage, put it into play. They're not going to kill you. You know, be in places where this might happen, and maybe the young people will take some witness from that and say, you know, if these guys care enough about this, they've been around, maybe I ought to care about that too. But I've talked too long here. Thanks. Oh, yeah, quick announcement.
So we have a little commercial interruption, except nobody's actually making any profit, so I don't know how commercial it is. But if what you've heard here has made you want to make sure that Hillary Clinton does not win New York, we have in the back there several hundred copies of The Battle of New York. You might have heard about it on Democracy Now! Or in The Nation. It is a broadsheet, and some friend there is holding it up. So we are making a big push in the next 2 days to distribute these widely. We have printed several hundred thousand of them, but it takes a grassroots army, and I hope I'm looking at the grassroots army. So please, on your way out, grab as many as you feel you can take and put in places where they may make a difference. That could be your building lobby, your laundromat, your favorite coffee shop. We're also going to be doing on Monday morning, evening, and Tuesday morning rush hour distribution at the subways. So if you feel like coming out and doing that, but please, I don't want to take them home. I have stacks like this in my kitchen already. So please take 50, 100 copies and get the word out, because I think what we've heard tonight, tells us that we really do not want New York to go for Hillary. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. And also as an article by Ray.
We can take questions now. Yeah.
Hi. Thanks so much for everything. I'm here tonight, and it's such an honor to have Scott Ritter here. 20 some years of, you know, fighting and doing what you're doing. Thank you so much. I have a question about, it seems like there's a short memory, because back when the Prime Minister of Lebanon was killed in Hariri in 2005, it was all over the media, this phenomenon called the Arab Spring. And fast forward 5-6 years later, and they didn't even bother to rename it something else, they just called it Arab Spring again. But in 2007, under the Bush administration, before there was Hillary or any of these people were talking about, there were nukes that went missing from the Minot Air Force Base, and they went down to Barksdale in Louisiana. I'm sure you're probably familiar with that. And they were supposed to be headed over to Syria when Israel bombed in Deir Ezzor. They claimed that they bombed a nuke site there. And I'm just wondering if you know anything more about that, because I was in Syria when that happened, and I was told by the Kurds in that town that it was Israeli and American pilots that were flying and that bombed Syria on that day.
Okay, the question deals with, I'm just going to, Chris, it basically comes down to the bombing in 2007 by Israel of a facility inside Syria, which Israel claimed to be a nuclear reactor under construction. And do I know
anything. I mean, I'll say right off the bat, you know, by 2007, my days as a UN weapons inspector were long past. So I have no direct knowledge. But I often say that, you know, you could be a brain surgeon. I'm not saying I'm smart enough to be a brain surgeon. I was a Marine, so we know that that's not the truth. But you can be a brain surgeon and spend 30 years, you know, doing brain surgery and retire, then 7 years later read about a new advancement in brain surgery, and you can have some insights as to whether or not this makes any sense or not, because you got 30 years experience doing brain surgery, and you can tell if somebody's making stuff up about brain surgery or not, even though it wasn't your brain surgery. I'm a weapons inspector. That's what I did. I specialized that. I was also an intelligence officer who specialized in weapons of mass destruction. I spent a lot of time trying to figure out what happened in Syria. A lot of my friends who were working with the Department of Energy, Sandia National Labs, did a number of studies in support of the thesis that this was indeed a nuclear reactor under construction. And I reviewed their work. I reviewed a lot of things. Let's just keep it very simple. There's supposed to be a nuclear reactor of a design that came out of England that the North Koreans acquired, and allegedly North Koreans were transferring this technology to Syria. It's a special kind of reactor that has special kind of construction requirements, including a special graphite-type block that goes in on the core that has very special absorbent materials. According to the intelligence report, this was in place when it was bombed. I will tell you right now that if you hit that with the bombs the Israelis were supposedly using, you would have scattered material that you can't erase by scraping the ground. You will find residue of this. The IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency inspectors, are very good. They found none of this, which tells me that what they claim to be a reactor wasn't the kind of reactor that they claim it to be, if it was a reactor at all. Now, there is a report that they found some sort of radiation, radioactive material, and then people jumped on and said this proves that this was a nuclear reactor. But the whole purpose of bombing it when they did was to bomb it before radioactive material had been inserted into the core. So their own story is there was no radioactive material at the site when we bombed it. That's why we bombed it when we did. But be that as it may, the radioactive material that they discovered, there's a couple problems with it. When the IAEA inspectors went in and did their swabs, you know, they take sample, they give some to the Syrian government, then they make duplicates, they take it back to their labs, they take it to other labs, so you have some sort of chain of custody and you have a proof. Nobody found anything, but the American inspector came up with something. It turns out that he had taken his own swabs, put it in his pocket and snuck it out, and cross-contaminated it with radioactive material was already in his pocket, and that was what they found. The other thing is that when the Israelis dropped the bomb, they dropped penetrator bombs that use a depleted uranium core. And this is also, it's not just depleted uranium. When, you know, people keep talking about DU, depleted uranium. But the fact of the matter is there's also, and the facilities that make this for military use, there's also natural uranium in there. And so you can find natural uranium samples when you do the environment. And this was all found and was used to prove that the Syrians were building a nuclear reactor. But the fact is it proves that the Syrians weren't, because it points to the fact that the only traces of radiation came from the Israeli munitions that were dropped. So long story short, you know, I can't tell you who dropped the bombs, you know, and all that kind of stuff. What I can tell you is what they dropped it on was more likely than not a nuclear reactor. And that this was all one big.
To the head of the shell operation guy on the ground there, and that's in the middle of their prime
right.
oil area. And he said, we monitor all the time for all kinds of isotopes and everything. That's part of what you do with oil refining. And if there had been anything of that kind, we would have picked it up immediately on the ground. He was a guy from Britain, and I talked to a guy who was American, and he was on the more the administrative side, oversaw the project, and he said the same thing. And I came back and I called the Wall Street Journal, I called Newsweek, I called Times, I called LA Times, I called The Nation, I called Democracy Now. Nobody wanted to hear any of this.
Well, the other thing I'll say is that a lot of high-ranking Syrians have defected since that time. And normally when you have a program like this, a defector will come out, they're going to spread the news that we have. And they've all said the same thing. We didn't have a nuclear program. That wasn't a nuclear reactor. So I'll stick with my analysis that that based upon the information that I've seen, based upon a detailed examination of the IAEA's report and what they found, what they discovered, it's highly unlikely that was a nuclear reactor.
Other questions? Yes.
I have 2 points which I would like to point out to you. Thank you very much. You've given a very, very good description of all the Machiavellian actions going on within the administration, etc. But what is the motivation of all this? It's not just merely politicians wanting to be elected. There is something beneath it that creates this necessity to engage in these activities. Changing regimes is something very, very serious. And no nation spends its treasury merely because you have a bunch of politicians who are doing these things that you spoke about. What is the motivation behind all this that is going on? My second point, which I would like to make, is I don't see any foreign policy coming from Bernie Sanders. Hillary Hilton has gone the entire nine yards in what she is going to do if she becomes president. But Sanders, there is really nothing. I'm speaking mainly about the Palestinian issue. He said, yes, the Palestinians should be regarded more as human beings, but that is not foreign policy. And I'm hesitating to vote for him as president should he get that, because I don't see any foreign policy from him emerging for the Palestinians. If you are going to have a foreign policy regarding the Palestinians, you say, I'm going to cut the $3 billion a year. I'm going to cut sending money off to Saudi Arabia. I'm going to reduce sending money to Egypt. But there is nothing of this in any way from Bernie Sanders. He is dead in the water as far as I can conceive.
I'll just give you my take on that, and maybe Ray can come in, because I have twin daughters, 23 years old, who are feeling the burn like you wouldn't believe. And their friends come over, and being the old guy, I'm put in front of them, and they grill me to death. And they don't accept that, you know, I'm Scott Ritter, and I have this great resume. You know, no, I have to go in and explain. And they don't hesitate to get in my face. And they were very upset about the New York Daily News interview that Senator Sanders gave, especially that attacked him on foreign policy. So pretty much the same points that you make. And they were looking to me to come up with an answer. And I had trouble coming up with an answer, but I came up with one that you know, first of all, the president is a visionary. The president doesn't make policy. The president sets an objective. To give you an example, to use the Bernie, you know, to use this standard that Bernie Sanders has to get down to the nuts and bolts. John F. Kennedy stood in front of the American people and said, we choose the moon. I choose to go to the moon. But if we apply the Bernie Sanders standard that the New York Daily News went, somebody should have asked him, well, how are you going to achieve delta V coming out of Earth orbit, and then how are you going to calculate the algorithm to get the approximate separation of the lunar module to land on the moon? Kennedy couldn't answer that. He has the head of NASA that does that. All Kennedy's job was to say is, I choose the moon. I choose to go to the moon. All I need Bernie to say is, I choose not to go to war in Iran. That's all I need him to say. I choose peace with Israel that respects the Palestinian people. Bernie's not going to come up with the nuts and bolts. To give you another example, Ronald Reagan, appropriate boos and hisses can be said at this point in time. But Ronald Reagan, you know, came in as this arch neoconservative, who was anti-Soviet, anti-communist, anti-everything. But at some point in time, the light went off in his head, and he said, "Nuclear weapons are bad. They're really bad." And he turned to his advisor and said, we're going to get rid of nuclear weapons. Now, I was one of the inspectors that went in the Soviet Union and got rid of the Intermediate Nuclear Force, you know, implemented Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty. This only happened because of the force of will of Ronald Wilson Reagan. He didn't know a damn thing about disarmament.
He wasn't going to sit there and tell you the nuts and bolts of the INF Treaty, very complex international negotiation with international law, with NATO, Warsaw Pact, United States, Russia, and all this stuff. If someone asked him how we're going to manage that from an international law standpoint, he didn't know. All he knew is he didn't want nuclear weapons anymore. He said, I don't want them. Get rid of them. So I'm not afraid of a Bernie Sanders saying, I want peace with it in Israel that respects the Palestinian people. I'm not afraid of that, as long as he surrounds himself with good people who will come up in the nuts and bolts. But Bernie Sanders or Hillary Clinton, whoever's the president, has to give us a vision, has to give us a vision statement. I don't want Hillary telling me how to take down the Syrian dictator. It's not her job as president. The second the president gets in the weeds about how we're going to do this, we done lost. It's not the president's job. The president's job is to step back and say, my vision is this. You make it happen. So who has the right vision is the question. And I think Bernie's leaning in the right direction. I agree with you. He doesn't have the greatest resume in the world. But damn it, he chooses to go to the moon. And I'm going to trust him to surround himself with people that's going to get us there. And when I say go to the moon, he chooses peace. And we're a nation that's been involved in war for far too long. So I'll take the man who chooses peace, and I'll trust him to surround himself with people that are going to get us down that path. But if you have a, you know, something you have to say to that.
No, I say amen.
Do you want to speak to his first question?
Why the question? Yeah, this is, I think that was incredibly well said. Now, I think reality is, getting back to the media, that I don't know if it's true or not, but yesterday there was some Daily News reporters that saw Bernie out for a walk, and they walked from the Henry Hudson Parkway across the Hudson River into the Palisades. And they prepared the headline for the following day. It's Bernie doesn't know how to swim. You know, Bernie's not going to get a fair shake in this town from the media. That's number one. Now, I just say this, that when Scott says Reagan said, hey, let's get rid of nuclear weapons, we almost got there, folks. We almost got there. And in Reykjavik, Gorbachev came with a concrete proposal to let's do that. An all-embracing proposal that shocked the hell out of everyone. But Reagan was thinking, wow, could we do this, you know? And his advisors, Fritz Ehrmarth and all those guys, said, what would happen to Star Wars, Mr. President? What would happen to Star Wars? ABM system, right? And they drew him back, said, no, we need to have an anti-ballistic missile system. We've got the technology. We can prevent the Russians from hitting us with this technology, all of which was a lie. It's the biggest corporate welfare system developed in the history of mankind. Everybody knows that except most of the American people. And when Gorbachev met with our former ambassador, Jack Matlock, who was the last ambassador of the Soviet Union, the first for Russia, okay, just a year ago, Matlock was there on a panel, and Putin said, now, Ambassador Matlock, why are you doing this, encircling Russia with the anti-ballistic missile system? You know they don't work. And Matlock said, now get this, Matlock, the consummate diplomat, he's a little old now, he said, well, it's primarily about jobs. It's primarily about jobs. So, to put the two together, Mark, as you suggest, we have a military, industrial, congressional, media, security services complex that would frighten Eisenhower into thinking he should have included Congress, as he meant to do in the beginning. These people are making lots of dough. The Saudis. Why is it that we don't know anything about those 28 pages? You know why? This is why. What is the amount of arms that U.S. arms manufacturers and what Pope Francis, to his credit, called the the blood-soaked arms traders, how much have they offered the Saudis just during Obama's tenure? Anybody know? Would you believe a $100 billion with a B? Now, people say, now McGovern, for God's sake, don't exaggerate. Only $50 billion has been approved. Now, I suggest to you that only is not an appropriate adjective to put before $50 billion. But there it is. Who's going to Saudi Arabia next week? Barack Obama. What did the Saudis do yesterday? They threatened that if we release the 28 pages, that they'd screw around with, you know, the dollar and all that kind of stuff. I don't even know how to exactly articulate it. But how, you know, first they said, oh, yeah, release it. And then as soon as there's a lot of pressure to release it, the Saudis said, oh, you do that, and we're going to screw up your whole economy. Well, you know, last thing here, not only do we have this complex, but we have a media that names one country as the most blatant conveyor of terrorism in the whole world. And you all know what that country is. What is it? Iran, right? Now, Iran used to do a lot of terrorism. But compared to Saudi Arabia, to Qatar, to Turkey, to so many countries in that area, Iran looks like, you know, the volleyball team for Mount St. Ursula in comparison, you know? They're not doing a lot of terrorism anymore because they don't have to. But the Saudis, look what they're doing. And look what they're doing in Yemen with our bombs. Thousands and thousands of people killed. So, you know, you ask why. Well, you know, I used to think, well, military-industrial complex, that's a little trite, you know. But, you know, I've learned a lot. You learn a lot watching all this stuff. And it's real. And it's very real. And with the anti-ballistic missile treaty that I had the privilege of being in Moscow in May of 1972, when Richard Nixon signed that, that was the most efficient way of stabilizing the strategic equation because it limited each side to just two ABM sites, okay? And with two, you can't prevent a retaliatory strike, okay? So that was it's not a nice thing, the balance of terror, but it did the job, right? Now, what is the first thing that George W. Bush did in this area when he came into office? He got out of the treaty. And so now there's ABMs all over the place, and Raytheon and Lockheed and all these people are making piles of dough. So Bernie is dead right out of this, you know? You don't hear Clinton say anything about this. So, you know, there's another area where there's a very distinct difference between the two.
I'll just give you a quick, because you did ask the question. I'm a former Marine, so I have trouble digging into these things because I'm a pretty simple guy. I wrote a book in 2010 on the history of America's disarmament policy. And researching that book was a huge revelation to me because I was going after pure arms control, and I found out it's all about the economy. You know, we emerged from the Second World War with an economy that is running on all cylinders. But remember, before the Second World War, we had this Great Depression, and we had issues with how we're going to fund the recovery. Roosevelt had some great ideas, but where's the money going to come from? Suddenly, we're the world's leader with this giant military and this economy that's geared towards the military, and you can't gear down without returning back to what we were struggling to get out of, without returning back to a recession and depression and all that. So, you know, the policy, you know, the Cold War policy of containment, of confronting the Soviet Union, was more an economic policy than it was a foreign policy. It was about sustaining an economy that emerged from the Second World War, finding the way to keep a permanent military thing. And Eisenhower talked about this, the military-industrial complex and all that. And it sustained us through the Cold War. And you have some continuity there of American policy, even though we had glitches. There was some continuity between 1945 and 1991. It was called the Soviet Union. It was called the Cold War. And then after the fall of the Soviet Union, you see American foreign policy going schizophrenic because we don't know what to do, because we no longer have this Soviet counterpart that creates a balance. We are suddenly the unilateral superpower, and you see us struggling to define our role in the world. and it's all about the economy. How do we come up with something to supplant the Soviet Union to justify the continuation of military spending, which constitutes such a major part of not only our economic base, but also the banking systems that are involved? And again, this comes back to Bernie. You know, people say Bernie has no foreign policy. His assault on Wall Street is the best foreign policy we have, because when you start to deconstruct the link between money and how America dominates the world, you realize that there's a direct link there, that if we allow the banks to continue to do what they're doing, we will allow foreign policy to continue the way it goes. The banks survive because America must be dominant in the world. And if you take the banks down, you make America realize that we aren't number one in the world, that we're one of many, and that we need to learn to peacefully coexist. Again, I don't know how it's going to happen, but I like the idea of a man who says, I have the vision to do it. And I don't think too many people are making the connection between his economic policies and foreign policy. And I do think that there's a connection to be made.
I'd like to, can I just jump in? As an academic outsider, I have no credentials comparable to either of yours, but I think that there's something else as well as the economic motive that underlies all this, and it's a little bit darker, and it also requires us to look back at the founding of the Republic, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, let's look at 9/11, which kicked off the war on terror. You know, the Patriot Act was already written and ready to go when that happened, and it looks like the Manhattan telephone book. It's enormous, right? And it is an enormous formal assault on our civil liberties, right? On the Bill of Rights. And that was only the beginning, right? I mean, you ask, what's behind this? I mean, it is in large part economic. There's no doubt about it. There's billions to be made endlessly on a state of constant mass panic and the government basically taking advantage of that panic to militarize police forces around the country and so on, right? And to make basically to blow away all of our constitutional protections and so on. What we see to this very day is an unprecedented assault on constitutional freedoms. It's actually worse under Obama than it's been under any of his predecessors. Speaking of Hillary, you know, Paul Krugman of the New York Times has really kind of disgraced himself by defying logic and economic common sense in various ways, with column after column attacking Bernie Sanders. One of his recent pieces was a celebration of what Obama has done right, okay? And the New York Times followed that piece with a bunch of letters from readers all weighing in on all the things that Obama has done right, and how he could have done this better, and he could have made these gestures. Not one of those letters, okay? Neither the column nor any of those letters mentions what has happened to American civil liberties under this president, right? I think under cover of the war on terror. Yeah. No, he has used the Espionage Act more than all previous presidents combined to go after whistleblowers. He has intimidated journalists and peaceful protesters, for example, right? He has cut back on FOIA requests. Some 70% of FOIA requests have been denied. Targeted assassinations, I mean, you name it, on an area after area concerning vital civil liberties. This liberal Democratic president has actually outdone Bush Cheney. He has gone further than Bush Cheney. So we're now, you know, living at a moment when both parties are complicit in translating a Republican system into a system based on constant fear. And I think that this is part of the motive behind creating a constant state of war. I mean, the framers understood that war actually threatens Republican freedoms, right? And creates the conditions for empire. It allows the president to function as a monarch. And that's would you agree? That's
exactly
kind of what we have today.
There's two prongs there. One's that, and one's the other. We're talking about the military-industrial complex. I'd just like to add this, that Ukraine was a great boon to the military, industrial, congressional, media, security services complex. A lot of those arms manufacturers were dead in the water. There was this one consortium, Maffei, from the German side, a French firm. They were building the common European battle tank, but they didn't have anybody to shoot at. The Russians were not threatening the men, okay? And so it was dead in the water. Oh, as soon as we mounted a coup in Kiev, and if we didn't expect Putin to make sure that Crimea wasn't given to NATO, we just didn't know anything about Russian history. As soon as that happened, whoa, all kinds. Well, Maffei is back in business. They're building the common European battle tank, which would be a duck sitting in water with the technology today. So this is very, very good for business. The other thing I'll say is this. In the emails that you see, Hillary's emails, you know, background. Amidst all this tension, Putin announces a 5% decrease in military spending. Now, you didn't see that highlighted in New York Times, but he announced that. When? Next year? No, this year, right? Yeah. Wow. What do we see in the emails? Thank God for the pivot to China. Chuck Spinney, who knows more about this than anybody, works in the Defense Department, and he says, you know, this is a boon, this pivot to China. I mean, if we run out of a menace from Russia, it's China even bigger, okay? So thank God for the pivot to China. And Jake, what's his name, Sullivan or whatever his name is, who's the sort of the campaign manager for Hillary, says, hey, yeah, and we invented that term, didn't we, Hillary? Wasn't that us that invented pivot? Yeah, right. You know, it's just so crass, you know. It just makes you sick, actually.
In the back.
I want to thank the three of you. I'm sure everyone here feels that. The question that I feel is like obvious and maybe a little too dire, but a view of what you've presented with your backgrounds as well, aside from the data you presented, is in the view of the prevailing forces that you described that are working, assuming the prevailing forces, the media, drive for corporate profits, Congress, military, industrial, business, if that all continues, are we headed for a police state to silence, with NSA silencing, any dissent forming in any way? So I'm not being conspiratorial. Are we, do you think, in your experience, we are headed for that? And if so, when, how much, what's the timeline on it?
Well, I think that the biggest threat to America is America itself. You know, and that's pretty much what we're talking about here. There's no threat outside of our borders that's capable of doing fatal harm to the United States. There's terrorist groups that can give us pinpricks here and there, and it's ugly and it's messy, but it doesn't threaten our very being. Russia does not threaten us. China does not threaten us. There's no North Korea does not threaten us. There's no nation that provides this fundamental threat to our being.
Serious.
Nobody. But the biggest threat to America is America itself, because we need fear. And this is why I was talking about the red meat. We need to have a boogeyman out there to generate the fear to justify the expenditures. Take a look at our military spending. We spend more than the next, eight nations combined together. We keep talking about the threat from Russia, the threat from China, but their defense expenditures are minuscule compared to what we put out there. But to justify this, we need these existential threats to be promulgated. And the other thing is, anybody who dares challenge the conventional wisdom is denigrated. I don't think we're at the point right now where jackbooted thugs are going to kick down the door and drag. Now, they're going to beat up 71-year-old men or something like that. But, you know, by and large, I don't think we're at at the point where the police state is going to take over. But they can marginalize you in other ways. How do you earn a living? I mean, if you're saying things that aren't in line with the corporate theme, how do you get the $200 an hour contract with CNN? How do you get the $7,000 retainer with Fox News? You don't. If you're not speaking from dogma and reiterating what happened, you don't make a living. How do you get funding to do research at the university level? If you're not playing the game, you don't get the money. And without the money, you wither and the thoughts die with you. You know, they don't have to put you in jail to silence you. They just have to cut off your ability to make a living. But the fact of the matter is, there's a growing movement out there, a social movement that's responding not only to how we interact with the world, but how we interact with ourselves. And this is where the militarization of the American police is such a huge problem. You know, police have to be of the community, you know, by the community, for the community, but they're not. Police are brought in as being a counter to the community. Police are at war with the community. This is an extension of how America acts with the rest of the world, and this is a serious problem, because the second we have our police going to war with the people they're supposed to be serving and protecting, we have a fundamental breakdown in what makes this nation, and that's the direction I think we're heading. And it's all about we're a nation of fear. We survive by promulgating threats, and then we have a economic, political, social machine that, you know, responds to these threats, and this response empowers a certain class in American society today, empowers them economically, empowers them politically. And anybody or any group of people that poses, you know, a serious threat will be shut down. They'll be shut down through isolation, sanctioning, and then they'll be shut down through the application of police force, no fly zones, intervention. It's the same thing, the same formula that we use to shut down problems abroad, we use to shut down problems at home. Right now, it's not systemic, so most Americans don't see this. Most Americans aren't affected by this. But the danger is when we allow the government, for instance, to change the laws on surveillance. Americans say, "Well, I've got nothing to hide. I'm not doing anything wrong. I'm not communicating with ISIS. So what do I care if they do X, Y, and Z to find out these bad guys that are doing these bad things?" The problem with the government is they never allow four corners to be drawn around a government power. Once you give the government a power to do X, it's not limited to person Y, you get the whole alphabet. And when you become a problem to the government, they will use the resources available to shut you down. Sometimes those resources are purely governmental. Sometimes there's a nexus between the government and non-government players. For instance, if you want to go work in a think tank, and that think tank receives millions of dollars in government funding, the government will say, if you hire this person, we'll withdraw the funding. This person now is unemployable. That's how this works. And so I think we're at that point now where if we don't stop this momentum, we're heading in a direction where we are a virtual military or police state. Yeah.
Thanks. On the threat, we're talking about the root causes. No one here has said the word petrodollar. Petrodollar refers to the fact that the dollar is the world reserve standard currency. Okay, so the boiled down nutshell, so I don't talk too much, the thesis I'm offering for your comment is, in a larger sense, that the reason why we have an empire, again, as you're saying, for economic reasons, so we can print lots of dollars and not have inflation go crazy in this country, because that's actually what's been happening. We've been printing lots of dollars. Inflation has not been going crazy because the petrodollar exists. Now, the petrodollar is backed up by the empire, isn't it? So there's your direct connection between the need for the empire, global American empire, to back up the petrodollar. You've heard the term petrodollar, right? That means that all petroleum has to be traded in dollars. And that's a significant fact. That is the most significant fact in the connection between our war policies and our economy, that we can print up as many dollars as we want and our economy will not go crazy and hasn't gone crazy because we pumped it up with a bunch of dollars, because the dollar is the world standard of currency. That's what allows us to print up all this money. You've heard about printing up all this money we're printing up?
Is there a question?
Yeah, well, that's what I'm asking your comment on. Where the question over here was, what is the root cause?
I would say before the petrodollar, yeah. you had the dollar. And what I mean by that is Bretton Woods. Is everybody familiar with Bretton Woods, the conference in World War II that basically told the British that the pound doesn't matter, the franc doesn't matter, all your international currencies don't matter. If you want America to fund your war, the dollar matters. It's the dollar that matters. The dollar becomes the currency of international commerce. And that's what's set in place. And that's what led to a large part of our conflict. If you go, it was George Kennan in his famous long telegram. What triggered the long telegram? What really triggered the long telegram is that the Soviets refused to buy into Bretton Woods. The Soviets said that we're not going to buy into the dollar, that the dollar is not going to be the unit of trade, that we're going to have the ruble. And that destroyed American hegemony, economic hegemony that we had so successfully. Franklin Roosevelt made a concerted effort during the war to destroy British and French empire by ensuring that the British pound and the French franc were not global economic players anymore, that only the dollar was. But the dollar was linked to the gold standard. I guess sometime in the 50s and 60s, we had an issue with the gold standard. We had to dump the gold standard. And now how do we float the dollar? And I think that led to the inevitable linkage between the dollar and petroleum. The interesting thing about the dollar and petroleum is, go ahead and chart the price of oil and how it goes up and down. Imagine what you do to money supplies when oil is $40 a barrel today, and yet tomorrow oil is $80 a barrel. Well, where does that money come from? It's printed. And then it goes up to oil is $120 a barrel. Where does that money come from? It's printed. And then the oil drops to $40 a barrel. Where is that money? It's all fake. It's all an artificial economy. It's all a giant bubble, and it can only be sustained by America continuing to impose its will on the world and getting people to buy into this artifice that is the dollar economy. I'm not an economist. I'm not smart enough to understand the intricacies of this. I'm a simple Marine, and the math of the price of oil and where do we get that money always confounds me.
I saw Jeffrey Sachs, the economist, about a week or so ago outside of a Hillary protest. She was at a fundraiser at the Dakota. He said that he was an economic advisor to Bernie Sanders, and I asked him that question about why doesn't Bernie talk about the fact that the dollar isn't even real, that it's just created out of debt and perpetuated. I don't know, maybe hopefully he'll mention it to Bernie Sanders. And then the second point, I wanted to thank you, first of all, for bringing up the banks, because they like to focus on the fact that, how is he going to do it? And like you said about JFK shooting for the moon, it's the same sort of goal with the banks. As long as that's the goal, how you break up the banks is, somebody else's job, too.
What's your question?
So it's basically just a comment.
Hi. Thank you all three of you very much. You're all great people and heroes of mine, and you're working together, and I thank you all very much. We owe all of us a great deal of gratitude to you, so thank you. I have a question, but you've inspired a comment, which I'll do the comment first, and then I'll ask the question, and you can comment on both of them. But in the beginning, the first comment is, Mark is absolutely right. There is something much darker and much deeper at play. Hillary Clinton and people born in Hope, Arkansas, are not the end all and be all. They're just the facilitators for the people who do have the money and create the money. Scott's point is right. This country was flat on its back during the Great Depression, and then all of a sudden, money just rained down. The P-51 Mustang that thus airplane during World War II was from drawing board to production in a year or something like that. And then tons of ships and all. The money's always there. But the word that we're not talking about, oligarchs, okay, during the war, they're either facing an existential threat or the opportunity to increase their global reach, right? So when that's at stake, the money's no problem. We could have spent it on bridges. We could have spent it on hospitals. We could do it today on all that stuff. So the economics, it's not like, we need defense because of economics. We could be doing the same money on stuff that doesn't blow people up and doesn't get disappeared as soon as it explodes. We could have a structure, a school, a hospital, and all that. So I'd like you all to comment on that, maybe, number one. Number two, I'd like to speak figuratively, I suppose, about the 800-pound elephant that's not in the room. Okay, and if we could all just hold our breath a minute and limit the discussion to foreign policy, when I heard Donald Trump on stage, on national television, with a bunch of Republicans say, the weapons of mass destruction was a lie, and the Bush administration knew it was a lie. I immediately thought of Scott Ritter, who we interviewed before the invasion, and he proved that on our show. It is common knowledge, and yet it cannot be said. Donald Trump rings the bell, breaks the glass, whatever you want to call it, and he said, Libya was a total disaster that we shouldn't have gone into, on the record of saying that beforehand. Syria, total disaster that we shouldn't have gone into, on the record beforehand. What Putin is doing in Syria is great. I could work with Putin. All these things totally against what you're allowed to think, what you're allowed to say. Those of us in the room here, we can think it and say it, but it's not going to get in the mainstream media. And supposedly he's on record as saying the invasion of Iraq was a horrible idea before it happened, okay? Now I know he's Hitler incarnate, and he's a proto-fascist waiting to just ruin everything, but on foreign policy alone, how do you all feel about that? Scott in particular, you're the one that I know it was a lie beforehand. I surmised, but I could prove it because of you. How did you feel when you saw this guy on stage having the temerity to say that to the world?
Well, the problem with Donald Trump is, I don't know if he is being a serious, you know, foreign policy participant and putting out bold ideas, or if he's being Donald Trump, the reality TV star whose job is just to shake the whole damn thing up.
Or he's being John Kennedy saying the moon.
No, that's what I mean. That was the first one. I mean, either he's being very serious, or he's just shaking things up to dominate the news cycle and undermine everybody else and keep his 44% share dominant over everybody else. I don't know. I mean, I don't know I don't know what kind of meat and potatoes is behind the menu. I'll give you another one. When he said NATO's outdated. I mean, hallelujah. About time we had a discussion about this Cold War artifact that today is searching for relevance. Hillary Clinton admitted, you know, we'll be looking for more missions for NATO. Why? Obama's in Saudi Arabia today to talk about some sort of nexus between the GCC and NATO to deal with ISIS. Is this really what our Cold War alliance needs to be doing? And yet Donald Trump put that out on the table. So what I'll say about Trump is that Trump is not of the, he's not the establishment. We know that. And that seems to be a good thing, because when you're not the establishment, you suddenly get liberated. You're no longer constrained by these the ties that bind you. You know, you're not beholden to Lockheed Martin. You're not beholden to Raytheon. You're not beholden to Shell. You're not beholden to all these entities that Goldman Sachs. You're not beholden to these entities that fund the very machine that you're trying to drive. So whether I agree with Trump or disagree with Trump, I will say that the fact that he can say what he's saying and continue to survive, shows that one, he truly is independent of the funds that drive the other campaigns. He's self-funding. But, more importantly, two, for better or worse, there's an audience. And this is where I see a glimmer of hope in America today. There's an audience out there for that message. He's not getting shouted down.
Right.
It's going to take a good politician, a good leader to navigate, because we're talking treacherous shoals here. Because you can take this anger and this resentment, and it can become a vehicle for good, or it can become a vehicle for bad. I see Bernie Sanders trying to tap into this anger and resentment and head us down the path of good. Trump, because he's in a different playing field, he has to delve into the dark side sometimes to survive, and it scares the living daylights out of me. But the fact of the matter is, there is an audience in America today for this new kind of thinking that doesn't automatically just shut down when you say, we need to consider the future of NATO, et cetera. So
I want to second that in a different way, and do so by going back to your point about the ways in which dissident views are punished. I mean, here, by and large, we don't kill journalists who stray off the reservation. I mean, Michael Hastings' death was very suspicious, and there probably are some cases where it has happened, but by and large, it's done much more efficiently, usually by tagging people who question the official narrative as conspiracy theorists. That's the thing that you hear over and over again. If somebody raises questions about deeper motives behind some, you know, war or some national adventure, or even mentions the possibility of a false flag operation, they're tagged as conspiracy theorists. This happens time and time again. There's a very good book by Lance DeHaven Smith called Conspiracy Theory in America that I recommend highly. I published it in a series of books that I edited for University of Texas Press. He demonstrates that the sudden use of that phrase throughout the American media, starting in the late 60s, was actually the result of a move by the CIA in order to discredit some people who were raising questions about the Warren Commission report. And the book actually includes, as an appendix, the CIA memo that was declassified in the 70s that reveals that he's right. Until 1967, the press almost never used that phrase. And you can look in the archives at the Times, the Washington Post, Time Magazine, see this for yourself. From 1967 on, it's used over and over and over and over again, you know, even about things that are pretty easy to prove, okay? Now, let me just move to the good news. As a professor here, you know, someone who teaches courses in propaganda and so on, year after year, I've noticed over the last few years that my students are not intimidated by that meme, okay? Formerly, if you said, well, you're a conspiracy theorist, people's, you know, you'd see the whites of their eyes and they'd become faint and they'd totter because that could mean professional suicide. You're screwed if you're tagged as a conspiracy theorist. You're also screwed as a professor in many cases if you're tagged as a conspiracy theorist. But now, I think because of digital communications, because it is so easy to question the official narrative about subject after subject after subject, just with the, you know, the pressing a few keys, you can actually compare what you read about Ukraine, for example, throughout the media. You can just compare that with stuff on Consortium News by Bob Perry, you know? You can, what's the guy's name who's married to Katrina Vandenhoevel, the Sovietologist? Yeah, right. You can see what Stephen Cohn had to say on Democracy Now! You can get the other side of the story far more easily and far more quickly than you used to be able to do, okay? So that my students, who by and large are not political at all, I mean, this is NYU, right? They don't have a political bone in their bodies. They are astonished to discover how false almost everything that we're hearing really is. And I have to say, you know, talking about to what extent we're a police state now, to what extent it's like 1984 here, I mean Orwell's 1984, I have never seen the media so unanimous on story after story, you know, whether it's Putin as the, you know, the world's biggest demon, whether it's Ukraine, whether it's vaccines, right? The stuff about the film that they forced Robert De Niro to pull out of, I mean, I watched that. It bears no relation whatsoever to the descriptions that we're reading all throughout the media, you know, time and time again by reporters who haven't even seen it, okay? It is really staggering to see. I mean, it is frightening, okay? But what I'm saying is that we've reached a moment when, in a way, it's kind of unsustainable. With young people, they don't really buy the official narrative anymore. If they just bestir themselves to make the slightest effort to look beyond, and I think this is why Bernie Sanders is so incredibly popular. Yeah. This is why he crushed Hillary in that ninth debate, according to every online poll, which you would never know reading the press that we have. Right? It's why Donald Trump is talking to his largely right-wing constituents in this really interesting way. You know. I mean, I don't know what his motives are. Nevertheless, these are the two candidates who are far and away the most popular because the whole so-called centrist apparatus, you know, which is fed by the military-industrial congressional complex, you know, the whole thing and the media's part of it is in precarious condition, okay? I don't know what they're going to do in order to keep it going. I shudder to think what they're going to keep it going, but basically, I think we have reason to be optimistic.
No, yeah. I also want to thank you all for courageously speaking truth to power and speaking truth about power and helping to pull the scales from our eyes and giving us a peek behind the edifices of power, even though that look is sometimes horrifying and terrifying. But when you were talking about the first Gulf War, which, of course, where they coined the term shock and awe, but it was shocking and awful, the one thing you didn't talk about, the highway of death, which was when all the Iraqi troops were fleeing and in their tanks and in vehicles, and it got bombed and incinerated, which was horribly shameful. And even though U.S. casualties were low, the troops, many more times more of that have died since then from so-called Gulf War syndrome, from DU. And of course, we have a situation where more troops now, even now, are committing suicide than are dying in actual combat, which is horrific. To go away from that, I spent a night in the tombs. I was arrested during the Republican convention, and when I was in New York, along with across from Ground Zero and a group that was organized by the War Resisters League, a group of 225 people, and they just basically told us, like, we walked right across from, I came from the from the PATH train entrance, just across the street. They there was a police captain on a bullhorn. He said, go ahead. He said, wait for the light, now go ahead. We went ahead. Next thing I know, somebody behind me says, they're arresting people. I look and there's orange netting. Oh, it's us they're arresting. I mean, it was completely ridiculous, unconstitutional, illegal arrest. And we were held, after being held in Pier 57, which was they made this like concentration camp in this bus, old 30-year-old bus depot that was contaminated with lead and arsenic. And in fact, it's ironic because I'm wearing the same shirt that I was arrested with that day.
Hopefully it decontaminated.
Yes. It has been washed. I don't know, washed thoroughly. Then I was in the tombs in 10 different cells there, so I had quite the tour of the place, including I was chained in handcuffs with in groups of five, chained together like we were going to go out. And I said, are they going to take us out on the highway to pack weeds or something? And at one point we were locked in two groups of five in a stairwell. And then they said, they come in, this police captain comes in, they're like, we have to do something with these females. And they're like, oh, we've decided what we're going to do. We're going to take you to the special place.
Do you have a question?
Well, I just wanted to mention this special place was this horrible cell in the bowels of the tombs that was this, had cockroaches this big, a toilet in the center, rickety carved up benches, paint peeling. It was unbelievable. And so, the thing that, this is unrelated to those two things, but some of us were very upset about the assassination of environmentalist and activist Berta Cáceres in Honduras. And one thing, she cited Hillary Clinton for being responsible for the coup in Honduras. So that, could you please address that a little more, her connection to that?
I don't know anything about it.
Well, it's very clear that Hillary convened these elections as soon as that fellow, the president had to flee. And the whole thing was a charade, you know. And look at all the Hondurans that are fleeing through Mexico or up into our area. It's all a direct result of the most repressive regime that Honduras has ever had. And that's saying something, you know. That's our doing. Now, I want to say, get back to, you know, it needs to be said one more time. And Bernie is right in saying it. And some of us were saying it 13 years ago, that the attack on Iraq was the most flagrant, stupid move in foreign policy that our country has ever made, because we knew what would happen. We put Shia against Sunni, and now that whole area is a shambles, okay? Now, why do I feel so strongly about that? I teach a course in a servant leadership school in Washington, and I had a woman in my course who was personal assistant to a woman named Hillary Clinton. And I was writing op-eds in the evening, and the Charlotte Observer or the Baltimore Sun, some of the Miami Herald, they wrote my stuff, and I give it to this young student, and I said, "Are you giving that to Hillary?" "Oh yeah, I'm giving it to her." "Is she reading it?" "Well, I think so. I give it to her." So I had this personal insight, you know, one person away from Hillary Clinton, and this is during 2002, 2003, and we're telling her, you know, telling her what we saw, and we never got to first base. I called up this woman, she's a lawyer now, and she won't call me back, and you know, I won't tell you her name because, you know, she's, I don't know how she feels about things now. But that was so blatant to me that she knew that this was, you know, this is not a mistake. That's the big thing. It was not a mistake. It was a calculated, cynical move to prove that she was real tough, right? She could be president sometime. And look what's happened. It's not 10,000. It's millions of people. Some of them killed, maybe a million, but what, 4 or 5 million people without homes, either in their countries or trying to get to Europe. Now the Europeans try to send them back. This is a cataclysmic catastrophe. And to see this person who aided and abetted this, despite getting pretty good information, and now she's trying to be president, that really, you know, the other thing I'll say is this, you know, she brags about you can't be neutral on Israel-Palestine. You can't be neutral. You can't be neutral, okay? Well, how the hell are you going to be an honest broker if you can't be neutral? 4 years of Hillary playing the, quote, honest broker role, you know, with various emissaries, you know, and not, she could be neutral. Well, hello, you know? So those things speak in spades to me, and their reality, that's what's happened. These are behaviors that we've seen. Now, I know that Scott has his own efforts to see Hillary Clinton because Scott was a constituent. Could you say a word about that?
Let me start. You know, people say, who are you to see Hillary Clinton? She's a U.S. senator. You're just Joe Schmo. Why would you want to see Hillary Clinton? And I'll start by talking a little bit about the first Gulf War. You know, I joined the Marine Corps in 1984. It's the height of the Cold War. I'm not a pacifist, just so you know that. All right. I joined for one reason only, and that was to kill Russians. And I'm being dead serious. I grew up as a child of the Cold War. My father was stationed in Turkey and Germany, and we had the communist horde over the border at all times. My childhood was living with the threat of imminent warfare. My dad would disappear at a moment's notice in a nuclear bunker, and the missiles would come out, and he didn't know if in the end of the week his family would be incinerated or not. That's just the reality. And I bought into this thing. I wanted to go and be ready to fight them, and I trained for it. I was a United States Marine Corps officer, and I was damn proud of what I did and the service I provided to my country. Now, I morphed. I got rid of an entire generation of nuclear weapons as a weapons inspector, but I fought in the first Gulf War. That was my war. We were told that Saddam Hussein represented a threat to international peace and security. And we were told that when we started this war that we were going to destroy, that the center of gravity of Saddam Hussein's existence was his Republican Guard, and that our entire campaign was focused on isolating and destroying the Republican Guard. Now, I don't take war lightly. If you're going to hit the on button, you're going to get a product, and that product is death. People need to understand that when you send the American military into war, we kill. That's what we do. That's the only thing we're programmed to do, is kill, and we do it better than anybody else. Now, a lot of people talk about the highway of death. The highway of death consisted of Iraqi soldiers and Interior Ministry troops who had pillaged the city of Kuwait and were fleeing from the city of Kuwait back into Baghdad. They were not innocent civilians. They were combatants in a time of war. And we do what you do to combatants. You blow up the lead vehicle, you blow up the rear vehicle, and you slaughter everything in the middle, because that's what war's about. You paid me, you paid my colleagues to go do a job, and we did the job. Don't expect any apologies about it. But you know what really irritated us? We didn't get to kill them all. See, that was our job. Our job was to isolate the Republican Guard and slaughter them. If you let the war go on another 48 hours, 72 hours, we would have slaughtered 30,000 more of them. And guess what? Saddam would have been gone. Mission accomplished. But they stopped the war because it was inconvenient to have the highway of death on TV. It was inconvenient for the American people to see the product of that which you wanted. When you you know, reap the whirlwind, you're going to sow it, all right? And this is why I've become anti-war, because I've seen war firsthand, and I've seen the other futility of war. War is about death and destruction. That's it. It's about killing. And by God, if you're going to ask me to kill, and you're going to ask other people to kill, it better be for a just cause. And it can't be a cause that's so timid and so shallow that an image of dead people on TV stops the war before the war objectives have been met. And that's what happened in the first Gulf War. It was a TV war. It was a show. It was a sham. And people got killed for no reason, Iraqi and American alike. And so I made it my objective when, you know, because then you know, my war didn't end in 1991. The troops may have gone home, but I went on to finish the war, the weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. And I spent the next 7.5 years leading weapons inspections inside Iraq trying to clean up this mess. And I saw that it was even a bigger sham than anybody ever thought. So armed with this, in the lead up to 2002, I thought that perhaps the best thing I can do for the men and women who were in uniform at that time was to make sure that if we were going to go to war, it was for a cause worthy of the sacrifice we were asking them to make. Because sometimes the greatest sacrifice a person makes in war isn't dying, it's living, and living with the consequences of what they were asked to do. And so I made it my goal to meet with every senator possible. I was summoned on to Washington, D.C. by Dianne Feinstein, who at that time was in the Senate Select Intelligence Committee. You know, she called up and she said, Scott, you're causing us a lot of trouble, because you got this credibility thing as a weapons inspector, and yet what you're saying is against the party line. And she goes, I'd like to meet with you. So I agreed, and I sat down with Dianne Feinstein inside her little secure bubble, and I said, Senator, if you can look me in the eye, I know you can't tell me about your top secret material, but if you can look me in the eye and tell me that you have seen a briefing that provides proof positive Iraq is pursuing weapons of mass destruction programs since I left in 1998, I'll shut the hell up, get out of your way, and let you get on with your merry way. She said, Scott, I can't tell you that. Then I said, I will then continue to make as much noise as possible. I got on the phone with the senator from Nebraska, whose name I can't remember. Hagel, Chuck Hagel. Yep. I'm getting old and senile. But and Chuck Hagel agreed to meet me. And I met with other senators. Now, I'm from the state of New York. We have this freshman senator. No, not freshman. She's been there for a year now. But she's our senator. Yeah. So I thought, since I'm meeting with these other senators, why not meet with my senator? And I called up her office, and I said, I'm ready to meet with you. I want to meet with you and talk. I just finished with Feinstein. I just finished with Hagel. I finished with a couple others. And I'd like to sit down and meet with you and talk about Iraq at this important vote coming up. Well, I got a hold of a staffer who said, well, we know Hillary's in the area. I said, well, I'm going to come in and I'll wait. And I got there, and I just got pushed off, put off. They wouldn't even take my name. The last thing they wanted to do is sit down and meet with me and go on the record that she had a meeting with me. And I've always wondered why that is. Why wouldn't she meet when these others would? And I think the answer is sort of what we talked about. It came to me in the flash of insight when Bernie Sanders released his taxes. What, he made $176,000? Bernie? Hillary released her taxes, not for this year, but last year, $23 million? Now, if I remember in 2002, because I lived in the state of New York, I lived in the New York City area, she went up and bought a home in Westchester, and they were dead-ass, flat-ass broke, she said. She had to get other people to buy that house in Chappaqua for her, because they had no money. Yeah. And so in 2002, she's someone who has no money. Today, she's making $23 million a year. Now I know why she didn't want to meet with me, because Hillary was all about buying into the system. Hillary is all about becoming the establishment. And becoming the establishment means that you vote the party line. You don't let the facts get in your way. The last thing she wanted was to be confronted with the facts about Iraq, because that would have made her vote extraordinarily inconvenient. It's so much easier when you can get up there and say, I believed this. But it would be impossible for her to say, I believe this, if she met with me, because she would have been presented with incontrovertible facts that contradicted the party line. And she and her staff opted not to participate. Now, I can't say that Hillary personally made this decision. What I can say is that in 2002, when I called the Senate's office, the senator knew. They never, ever ignored me. They could call back and say, we can't meet, we don't want to meet, but they never ignored me because I was a credible voice about the topic of our time. Hillary was the only senator's office who ignored me, and she was my senator from my state. And
sitting in to try to convince her not to.
Yeah, I think that's QED, as we used to say in geometry class. You know, that's what is to be demonstrated. And I just want to say that we veteran intelligence professionals for sanity have refused to take any government funding. what I'm saying is that we're a movement more than an organization, but there is incredible freedom in this movement. The article that we posted today on consortiumnews.com has Scott Ritter, has Matthew Ho, and has William Binney from NSA commenting on, from a professional, Binney, 36 years in the NSA, retired as a technical director, okay? You know Scott's pedigree? Matthew Ho, Marine, Iraq, and then senior Department of State official in Afghanistan. What I'm saying here is I call him up and I say, hey, nobody said word one about Hillary's emails. Bernie said, forget about it, right? But that was a, you know, it may all redound to his credit. But the FBI is concerned, the NSA is concerned, and everybody who communicated with her in a secure way, what they thought was are concerned. So this is sort of a little ad, okay? When you go home, look at consortiumnews.com, see what we have to say just about the emails, just about those, and see if that is not enough to disqualify anyone who seriously wants to be president because of the arrogance, because of the above-the-law attitude, because of the sheer incompetence of allowing this kind of sensitive material to be gobbled up by whatever. You know, if they could do that to the OPM, the Office of Personnel Management, you know, what, 17 million files from security clearances, they certainly have done that to Hillary. And as I said before, there's blackmail potential in there as well. So we got 2 days before the primary. Tell all your friends. I mean, tell them that this is really a big deal and that Bernie is not going to press it, and maybe that's a smart political move. But we know, and we feel a professional obligation to tell our fellow Americans, we've been there, and when people have done that, it's been real, real trouble.
Do you think she'll be indicted?
I know that lesser officials have been indicted. I know that David Petraeus, who gave his mistress the family jewels, I mean, he's caught in saying that, oh, this is code word stuff, and above code word, you know, this is gamma stuff, and, you know, I can't tell you what gamma, I could tell you what a gamma is, but then I have to shoot you all, right? Okay. So what did Petraeus get? Well, Obama told Eric Holder, who I'm ashamed to say comes from the Bronx originally. Eric Holder, he told, look, before Lynch comes in as Attorney General, would you give Petraeus a slap on the wrist, okay? And make sure that, he did lie to the FBI, that's a felony, but let's let him off on a misdemeanor. And let's find him $100,000. Now, how much does Petraeus make for one speech? Same as Hillary, $220,000, okay? So that's sort of like 20 minutes out of an hour speech for Petraeus. So that's the double standard right there. Now, what will they do to Hillary? Well, you know, she's made more money for these speeches. Maybe they'll say, whoa, Hillary, you have to pay $200,000, and so next speech she makes to Goldman Sachs, she only nets $35,000. It's ridiculous. If she were someone else, she would be indicted, and she would be indicted in the Alexandria court, which is which no one gets exonerated or unguilty from. So what I'm saying here is that this is a big deal, and we didn't really realize that until we said, you know, nobody's saying anything about this. Bernie gave them an out here, and sure, that Latino guy a couple of months ago did say, you know, Hillary, if you're indicted, will you cease your campaign? You remember what she said? Anybody?
That'll never happen.
Yeah, she says, that's not going to happen. That's all I want to talk about. Well, you think Obama has already told her? I think he has, you know?
I think one of the biggest problems is the 22 emails. The other stuff she's not going to get indicted over. I don't think that, I honestly don't believe she's broken the law. I think that they have a precedent with Condoleezza Rice and Colin Powell on the use of a private server. There's no prior prosecution of those two. It's going to be hard to come up with a unique case for her, et cetera, et cetera. The issue is 22 emails that are top secret and above. And the problem is how do you prosecute without revealing what's in those emails? And I think that's where she's going to slide, because I think the government's going to, you know, make a corporate decision that they're not going to prosecute, because in order to prosecute, it's like during the Cold War, you know, when we, you know, had Aldrich Ames and all these, the reason why they didn't get the death penalty and they got life is that they agreed to plead guilty to avoid a trial, because to go to trial, the government would have had to present a lot of highly classified information the government didn't want to present. And the government said, if you make us go through this, we're going to kill you. And they said, okay, we'll plead guilty, avoid the trial, and the government avoided the need to present this. Hillary said, release all the emails, knowing full well they can't release the 22. Therefore, she could say, I've asked for them to be released. And the government can't release them because, depending on who you believe, these might be 22 emails that contain the most highly classified intelligence information categories of intelligence information in America today. And if she did use them on an unclassified server, then this information is, without a shadow of doubt, in the possession of foreign intelligence service, some of whom might be hostile to the United States of America. And if she's responsible for having that information transition in the hands of a foreign government, she's committed espionage. This is the kind of stuff that puts people in jail for an awful long time. There's a lot of speculation going on here, but I just don't think this is going to get very far because of the nature of those 22 emails.
That's not the point, how far it gets. You know, as much as I'd like Hillary to spend the night in the tombs, you know, I think everybody else in America might, but I don't care about Hillary. What I'm saying here is that we know from our own profession, NSA, Marines, you know, CIA, all the people that we have in this little group of veteran professionals, we know how damaging that was. We know what kind of arrogance and what kind of above-the-law attitudes can do to the security of our country. Not only risking lives and limbs, but risking billions, literally billions of dollars on programs that get revealed by allowing highly classified stuff to get on these 22 messages. So I don't care. I don't care what happens to her. What I want to know, what I want people to know, is that this was very serious, and it's not to be brushed off as something, I don't care about your damn emails, I'm tired of hearing about your emails. We swore an oath to defend and protect the Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and we didn't say until we got tired. And we didn't say until we got retired, okay? It has no, what's the word, expiration date. And we just thought that's our special contribution that we can make and say, look, this is serious. You're not being told how serious it is. Just be advised that this is an attitude that can really endanger our national security and almost certainly already has.
All right, we have to stop. It's 10 o'clock. Thanks so much for
You're most welcome. It was fun.